So, in the interest of good streaming, I will not begin this session with just atonal screaming. And one of my favorite podcasts does that.
Oh,
all
yeah,
right, then.
Surprise.
You say that like it's never mind. All right, mammals, we have here our first session of Aberrant. Yay, Aberrant.
Huzzah!
Huzzah! All right. For the good of the exactly two people who might be paying attention to us, let's go ahead and have a brief introduction of each PC, and for that matter, each player. We'll start with Gretchen, since she's at the top of my screen. Or Rob, either one. They're on the screen.
Gretchen's first. Not it.
It's left to right. PEMDAS.
My name is Gretchen. I do role playing. I don't know.
Your character too.
I'm an exhausted parent. How's that?
That's redundant. Every parent's exhausted.
It's true. I am playing a smash and bash character named Frash, who is an ex-fighter. And a little traumatized from when her powers came to be, her when she Nova'd, right? That's what it's called.
Erupted.
She erupted. Erupted. But I guess we'll discover that as things go on. But she is kind of muscle for hire.
Excellent. Awesome. Rob.
So I am Rob, and I am playing Alexander Alex Rene Ford, better known in the superhero Nova circles as the White Privilege. And he is an ultra rich, very attractive sort of playboy, brings very little to the world that anybody would consider valuable. Always dresses all in white, white sunglasses, white suit, finest like cut white suit, white sports car, and usually a white rose in his breast pocket. And he has hired Crash as his personal bodyguard. So yeah, that's what folks would really know so far.
Awesome. Travis, who are you? What do you do and why do you do it?
Hi, my name is Travis. I am a longtime White Wolf veteran gamer. I knows the rules. I'm playing a character named Eddie Mason, who goes by the Nova name of Advent. He was a construction worker who erupted rather spectacularly during an accident at his job. He's more of a working man type, so outside of any U-fiber suits that he may wear as Advent, he tends to show up in jeans and work boots and either some form of just t-shirt or working man's button down. He also looks to be around maybe 40.
Nice. And Howard.
Hey, I'm Howard, pronouns he, him. I have been playing White Wolf since I was 18. I am now 40. You can do math. I am currently playing Agent Tom Hughes. He's a baseline, which is basically the equivalent of a human that works for the Chattanooga municipal government. He tends to be a Nova Wrangler, just sort of, okay, let's go. Okay, we have a photo shoot at 3, and now we have to go deal with this hostage situation, and then we'll make the 6 o'clock news. Hopefully, please keep the casualties down to a minimum. Please, no racist comments. We need to keep this clean. He's just kind of, he looks pretty boring. Hey, look, I even cosplayed. It's great. Tom Hughes is also he, him. So there you go.
And Garet.
My name is Garet. I don't know if I can claim White Wolf veteran, but I definitely have played it before, just not anywhere near as proficient as Howard, Amanda, and Travis. I'm more of the D&D world. I am playing Lightweight. That is my Nova name. He's very new to Chattanooga, and he's known for his ability to just phase through solid objects. Walking on air because of the density control. So hence his name.
Excellent. And I'm just letting y'all know that Travis actually knows the mechanics at least as well as I do. So it is perfectly cool and fine and happy with me if he happens to be able to hop in with the answer to a rules question before I get to it. Since I have absolutely no problem saying, yes, he's right, but we're going to rule of cool it this other way if I have something else in mind. Just FYI.
I am also rule of cool.
Yes. But yeah, basically a mechanics answer from him is just as good as one is from me. Because he Donka. Probably knows things as probably better than I do. Yeah.
Okay. In a minute. Cool.
All right. Excellent. Well then, this game will be set in Chattanooga, Tennessee, which I am reasonably familiar with, and the rest of y'all not quite so much. Some of y'all have been in town significantly longer than the others, but being mostly Novas, it doesn't really matter how long you've been in town. You're typically well known unless you make it a hardcore effort not to be. As a result, the question then becomes how much contact do y'all want to have had with each other? I know we tried to discuss this in session zero, but we didn't get a solid answer. So let's take a couple of minutes to get that ironed out right now. I know that Howard has offered to be point of contact Nova Wrangler. And I know that Advent is a fairly recent eruption. And Robin, White Privilege, and Crash have their own separate relationship. So.
I'm assuming that Lightweight has actually not been in Chattanooga long.
Right.
So he probably has not even had the chance to meet anyone else yet, other than when he did. He's going to know Agent Hughes because of the background screening and, you know, all of that when he came to the city.
Excellent.
You know, when he came, because he came to the city because of some folks he knew, and they're recommending that he get involved with the city's whatever hero teams they have as a way of just giving back. So, you know, I'm assuming I've probably only been in Chattanooga probably less than 2 weeks.
Awesome.
It might be easiest then to state that while we may know of each other, because Novas tend to know of each other, this might be the first time we get wrangled together, if that's what everybody else is okay with.
Everybody okay with that?
Yeah,
I'm fine with
me.
Awesome. Excellent. Okay. Well then, as all of y'all who have paid any attention to the local news know, there has been a set of murders taken place in Chattanooga. The earliest one that the media has been aware of was December 30th. The most recent one that the media has been aware of was on January 23rd, or at least that's when the body was discovered. And while not a great deal of information has been released publicly, there has been a quiet effort made to put together a Nova team to deal with the problem. And y'all are it. As a result, Agent Hughes has sought out, y'all out through your various contact information, brought y'all all together, and there's a briefing. The chief of police is actually sitting in to give y'all the information that they have available to them. And let me pull that up real quick. That would be Chief of Police Celeste Murphy. She is a baseline, since most police still are. And it's going to be Celeste Murphy, putting that in chat. Excellent. Okay. Cool. She has taken time out of her busy day to deal with, well, the elite people that she has asked to help out with this situation. Now, I'm very glad that all of y'all have seen fit to join me today. We are very grateful for your assistance and hope that you will be willing to take on this task for us, since, as you are about to find out, this situation is uniquely of concern to the Nova population, or at least what might at some point become the Nova population. Though we have kept as many of the details out of the media as we have been able to, there have in fact been at least 8 and possibly as many as 11 murders. The media is aware of 5. Most of these murders have one thing in common. Well, all of them had massive trauma to the head, and most of them had one portion of the victim's brains removed. That portion being that tiny little, what do you call that, a gland, a node.
Machin-Rashad node.
That, thank you, Agent Hughes, yes. That was removed. Now, none of our victims were, in fact, Novas. However, it is my understanding that the presence or absence of that little node is what makes the difference between whether somebody can potentially become a Nova in the future, or if, when confronted with whatever sort of trauma causes y'all to do y'all's thing, if yet they don't have that little node, then they just die. So, for all that these people were not Novas, they all potentially could have been. Which makes this a problem to be properly dealt with by Novas. Not to mention the fact that, well, my staff is highly skilled and trained, but we have not been able to make a great deal of progress on this situation. As a result, you 5 will have... Gosh! We'll have whatever resources we can make available to y'all in a consideration of the majority of y'all not being officially parts of the police department. That does limit the sort of weaponry and things that can be released to you. Not that I expect that y'all would need any such thing. Agent Hughes here will be your point of contact with regard to that. But we will make whatever resources available to you that we can. And in the meantime, here is the complete list of the people that we have our list of victims. She's obviously not used to dealing with persons of y'all's exalted nature. Wrong game.
Yes. The first thing that we're going to need, and I think I speak for everybody, is drugs. We're going to need to take a look at all of your drugs. For if I'm not mistaken here, and I think that, was it Agent Hughes can speak to this, that there is quite a delicious drug which can be made from those nodes. And so I think we ought to thoroughly investigate the drugs that you have in evidence in case any of those drugs might match up with the types made by these nodes. So, lead the way.
Let's finish the briefing before we get to the drugs.
Guy's dead. We got to find the killer.
8 to 11 people are dead.
Drugs,
yes. Let's also see what other evidence they might have.
Go on.
Thank you.
while he's going on his drug rant, Eddie just quietly slides the list over and starts looking it over.
Yeah. She hands out a list of names for each of y'all. The highlighted ones are the ones that they've successfully managed to keep out of the papers. Now, as you have noticed, perhaps, the list is divided into two groupings. The list at the bottom, the only three people on it, are set aside because while we are reasonably certain that the same people have been perpetrating all of these crimes, those three people did not actually have anything removed from their brains, because they did not have one of those nodes to remove.
Okay, so that answers one of my questions that I was wondering.
Which would be?
Well, how did they know that these people had the node? So they don't. It looks like they're making some assumptions.
That would be my opinion as well, sir. That would be...
Well, that would be the wrong opinion, because if you look at the dates that are happening here, you can see that those without the nodes were amongst the first killed, and all of the recent deaths have been ones who have had nodes. So whoever is perpetrating these crimes has obviously figured out a way to know, to see if these victims have nodes at this point.
That might very well be the case. And when I contacted Project Utopia for their advice and input, they told me, their representative told me, that it was currently extraordinarily difficult to determine in advance which baseline humans had Nova nodes, had the potential to erupt. My understanding is that there are two, perhaps three pieces of highly advanced medical equipment in the world that can make that determination prior to someone actually erupting as a Nova. So while it does seem that you're correct that whomever has figured out a way to determine pre-Novahood, as it were, such a thing is not currently understood to be possible. I'm sure you understand that quite a few people would be interested in having that information should it be able to be reliably demonstrated.
Do we know if that...
Time for drugs now.
Do we know if any of that medical equipment was in town, and if so, has it been stolen?
To my understanding, one of those pieces is in New York and another is in Paris. And they're both very large pieces of equipment. So I believe we would have been notified, or there would have been something in the news should such a thing have been taken.
Hmm.
apart from Mr. White Privilege's interest in our drug lockers, which I'm sure you understand, I can provide an inventory if you truly believe that to be necessary. But as far as accessing said drug locker, I do not believe that is out within the purview of this investigation. We do, in fact, have quantities of might that have been confiscated, which might, of course, as you know, has been created from, how do I put it delicately, hormonal secretions of Novas. But if that is not a thing that is requiring the murder or the brains of baselines who have not erupted. But we do, in fact, have some might on in the evidence locker. However, this does not seem to be a connection.
Well, as someone who has to watch his ass, I think it's best that you do keep the drugs away from him.
I fully intend to do so, ma'am.
Also,
until our designated drug-taking hour.
Well, I understand your hesitation, but I believe thus far there have been, what, 8, 9 murders that you haven't solved yet, which is the reason why we're here. So I'm going to perhaps suggest that you take some different angles and tactics since you have shown to be incompetent so far.
Okay, right privilege.
I'm trying to do some skills here. I don't know what I do, what skills I do here.
I'd love to pop lie detector.
Intimidation?
Lightweight is just kind of something. Lightweight is just kind of looking at the others, kind of like cutting his eyes. Like,
what have you gotten yourself into?
this has gone south in a hurry.
Indeed. And yeah, Celeste does not look happy. No.
What does Celeste look like?
Can I do like a skill to like try to like essentially kind of convince? That's what I'm trying to do. Like, I don't know how to, but I don't really know what I'm supposed to do. Is it intimidation? What is it? Charisma? Command?
Command would probably be, well, depends on how much you want to annoy her, really, as to whether you want to do command, intimidation. You could probably do manipulation. Rapport. Manipulation would be the attribute, definitely.
What does she look like, Amanda? Because I've got her name, but I...
Yeah.
Deeply annoyed is what she looks like.
There you go.
Oh, God. Oh, in
hey!
That case,
is literally named White Privilege too.
Is literally going with
you. So the people watching at home cannot see this picture, but she is basically one hard-ass looking black woman who doesn't look like she's about to take any S from some rich guy named White Privilege.
And the funny thing is, this is actually the current Chattanooga police chief.
Oh, that's so great.
Oh.
All love to Celeste Murphy. I have no idea if I'm getting the accent correct.
That's fine.
Lightweight is very quickly going to chime in and go, perhaps you might rethink the way you speak to the police chief, seeing as how she is, you know,
employing us.
All right. Very well. Let me put it a different way. Is there a way that we can requisition these drugs in an official capacity? Perhaps there are some forms we can sign, or
I have a suggestion.
Some hoops that we can jump through fairly quickly to get access to these drugs.
What is your suggestion, Advent?
He looks at the police chief and he smiles just a little bit and he goes, perhaps it would be best to discuss this group becoming official consultants with the police department, which would allow us certain access that we otherwise wouldn't. It would be mutually beneficial. I would like to use Persuader.
Nice.
Yes, so yes. As Mr. Eddie says.
Excellent. So
that's three. Eddie's fine for now.
Okay.
I automatically get three successes.
I'll say Mr.
Yes, Rob is, well, Travis is working out his roles. Let's say if you wanted to do manipulation or charisma command, or if you want to wait for
Eddie to work his best. Annoying and totally unlikable for the time being. In contrast to my companions.
I'm dropping one quantum for lie detector and one quantum for soothe.
If I remember right, it's sevens and up, right?
Yes, please.
Plus the three automatic successes, I just got six.
Nice. She rather gratefully turns to the sensible member of the to the new team. I do believe that would be a very useful suggestion, sir. And she sort of sticks her head out of the office door, yells down the hall. I believe that we can indeed get that taken care of right this moment and put y'all on retainer to the police department for the duration of this difficulty. Now, of course, that does mean with y'all working as consultants to the police department that we do have some expectations of public behavior.
The public doesn't need to know that we're consultants.
But if the public were to find out, then there would be problems if there had been outrages.
Of course, nobody wants to actually find out that Novas are running around unsupervised and given carte blanche from the city. You know, clearly we would be expected to take care of, you know, as much property and people as possible and not be reckless with our powers.
I see you understand my meaning perfectly, sir. And an assistant comes in with a stack of forms, which he passes y'all out, that basically signs y'all on as consultants to the Chattanooga Police Department. Hughes is already employed, so that's not a problem. But the rest of y'all, basically the form says that you understand that you are associated with the police department, will make every effort to not be a disgrace, and will keep collateral damage and mayhem to a minimum.
And probably also not act in a way to embarrass the police department, blah, blah, blah.
That too. The standard boilerplate of please just, oh God, don't.
don't act the fool and embarrass us. Don't make us regret hiring you.
Yes.
Easier for some of us than others.
Have full faith.
You'll do just fine. Don't worry, Crash.
I have full faith in y'all's abilities to complete this assignment with accuracy and speed and minimal problems. Hughes, your lie detector she's very concerned. Not. Yeah, she's highly concerned. Oh yeah. She's having thoughts and regrets.
If nothing else, Madam Police Chief, you have us on, and he's actually holding up a form, although my Zoom is not working. He's holding up the forms. Not to worry, Madam Police Chief, you have us on contract.
Exactly, sir. And once y'all have signed the forms. Well then, Mr. White Privilege, do you truly find it necessary to view our
drug supplies, locker?
Our drug locker, or is simply knowing the quantity of the substances we currently have sufficient for you?
I don't understand why we would even need to look at the drug locker unless some of us are biochemists. I'm not.
Neither do I, but I will admit that I am, well, y'all are the first Novas that I've had extended contact with, so I do not claim to fully understand the way you do things.
And I will also say there are experts in chemistry and biochemistry, and then there's experts because they just take a lot of drugs and somehow come back from them.
Now, I'm not the brilliant minds that all of you obviously are, but it does seem to me like some testing on some of these drugs might actually make some sort of sense in order to determine if the DNA found in these drugs might actually match some of the DNA of those
from who the victims taken.
But I don't know. Maybe I'm just the one who wants to do drugs and is an idiot here.
You can be both.
Fair, fair.
I believe that we could release very small quantities of what we have in the evidence locker for testing purposes.
Yeah, just a couple of bumps, don't worry.
But again, I don't have the ability to test for DNA.
Well, there are labs.
There's a chat. I'm sure that the forensics with the police department could either run them or send them off for testing.
Right. Why do we physically need the custody of them when we wouldn't the experts be better for this?
We can certainly send DNA samples of both the drugs that we have on hand as well as our current victims for consideration and testing. That is not a problem and a very good idea. I'll have that taken care of, though likely the results will take a few days.
Chief Murphy, something is bothering me. So I'm going to ask a question that is going to be relatively pointed, though possibly less prickly than my compatriots. What else aren't you telling the media? And also us.
Well, we have, as I said, we have managed to keep the quantity of murders out of the media's gaze so as to prevent the public from having a panic. 5 murders is bad enough, but 11, even 5 makes a serial killer, but 11, that's nationwide news.
How were the victims subdued?
That's actually what I'm trying to get to. You're saying that these 11 victims were perpetrated by the same person because of the pattern, but like, what's the pattern aside from the fact that the MR nodes were moved? Is there anything else that points to this being one person over a crew or anything like that maybe hasn't been discussed? The most more information we get about how these murders have happened gives us the best avenue of success.
Basically, we need each finding from the crime scenes. Yeah.
Certainly. As far as it being one person versus a crew, I strongly believe it is in fact several people involved. It seems unlikely that whoever is doing the abductions and subduing of our victims, it's probably not the same person who is performing the surgery. What we have also managed to keep out of the news is that the skill of the surgical procedures started out as very, how shall I say it, amateur, but has greatly increased in its skill and precision as the murders have continued. And indeed, what concerns me is that we have stopped finding bodies, but that does not necessarily mean that the murders themselves have stopped. I can't help but be concerned that whoever's doing this may very well have been stockpiling or caching bodies, or perhaps found another way of disposal that we have not managed to find yet. The problem may be significantly larger than we are aware.
How widespread have the bodies been found? I mean, I'm fairly new to Chattanooga, so we've got these names, but geographically, where are they?
They have been scattered all over the greater metropolitan area, and I've dropped a map into both of the chats with everything marked on it. With one exception, each body has been dumped separately. There has been one incident where a pair of them were found together. As far as any sort of a pattern, to perhaps misquote a movie, it does seem to be desperately random in the disposal rather than any sort of actual pattern of placement.
I'm not seeing anything on the map that indicates where the murders were. Is there an icon? I just see a map.
It's the little numbers with yellow.
Yeah, there's yellowish orange letters and numbers, which probably should have been larger.
Number one is near Spring Creek, which is
I know, and they blend right in.
They look like it looks like you just it's like the map.
Yeah. The little flags. Okay.
Yeah, I zoomed in because that's the only reason. The first one I noticed was really at the top of the map. I could see the letter B because it was by itself near the Hickson.
Yeah, sorry. Between sessions, I will remake this map in a more.
I mean, no. Now that I know what it is, it's great.
I mean, I could throw it into paint right now and just make really big X's. No, it's okay.
But the two that were found together, that's in the bottom right hand corner near Boyd Speedway. Those are the only two that were found together.
Were those two
numbers 5 and 6?
Yep. Were those two people, were they associated with one another?
They were both among our unhoused population. I believe they tended to operate out of the same shelters. They stuck together for protection, as far as I don't know of any particular family. To my knowledge, they were not family, but they were friends, at least in
This isn't all a bunch of homeless people, is it?
No, those were the only two homeless people.
Good.
No, let's see here.
Also, any suspects, any known Nova criminals or baseline criminals that you may be thinking about? Who would be, I guess, malicious enough to do this?
Well, now, we have had several Novas to erupt in Chattanooga, as I'm sure you're aware of. We don't exactly know why Chattanooga is such a haven for eruption, though it has certainly seemed to be the case. As far as criminal elements of the Novas who have erupted here, turncoat, adversary, and I suppose, depending on how you consider blackjack, could all be considered potential suspects, though adversary at least was much more in the way of entrepreneur, if you was take my meaning to my... He was more into the idea of a businessman as opposed to murder, though I would not have put it past him to have branched out, though he disappeared several years ago. We have no reason to even assume he is still alive. Turncoat is still known to be active, but no known whereabouts. And Blackjack, he's employed with the DeVries Agency as an elite, but he was last seen in Tunisia, though whether he's still there or not is remains to be seen. As for the other Novas who have erupted outside or in within Chattanooga, none of them are of a criminal persuasion. Indeed, most of them are working for Utopia.
Eddie makes a face at the mention of Utopia, like, bleh.
Here is a list of the known Novas to have erupted in Chattanooga. Now, of course, it is certainly possible that there are other Novas who are currently in Chattanooga. They pass through on a semi-regular basis. But if there is someone of a criminal persuasion, they have managed to keep their presence on the down low.
I would like to see all the autopsies.
We can certainly get that information for you. She sticks her head back out. And a little bit later, several files, one for each of the victims, comes in. Some of them are significantly thicker than others, though there is an autopsy report on each of them.
The files that came in with the autopsies, I'm guessing this includes information about the victim that the cops were able to find?
Correct.
Yes. Like, yeah, like Hughes will take one of them and start looking through and... Yeah.
Amanda, quick question for you, and this is more for me as the player. Uh-huh. So the node itself that we have that allows us to erupt, can that node be removed without killing the person, or will it kill them? Do we even know that?
Y'all don't actually know that to the best of, I mean, as far as like publicly known science and medicine, it's never been attempted. Mainly because outside of those couple of highly like skilled, impressive MRI machines, it's not possible to know whether somebody has the node before they erupt. So it would take either those machines or exploratory surgery to locate the thing. It's certain that removing the node would prevent the person from ever erupting. As to whether they would survive the experience, like I say, it's never been tried to anybody's understanding.
Okay.
Yeah.
While everybody's talking, what Eddie does is he actually opens them all up on a table and puts them all on the autopsy report so he can see them all, and he just starts speed reading.
Nice. Excellent. All right.
He'll be looking for patterns that the cops might have missed while they're talking.
Gotcha. Well, what you find is what white privilege observed, that the whoever's doing this has gotten better and gotten better quickly. That the first three, Leroy Thomas, Barbara Jacobs, and Arthur Walsh, their heads were, it looks like all three of them were, they had taser marks on them. That was probably what was able to originally subdue them. And that each of them, it looks like their skulls were basically sawn open, like with a bone saw. And obviously Leroy didn't have anything to remove, so nothing was removed. Neither did Barbara Jacobs. But Arthur Walsh's, there was disturbance of the other brain tissue around it, like the node was removed it looks like it was more interested in removing the node itself than not causing any other damage, like to the other brain tissue. But of course, since the person was going to be dead, that, you know, whatever.
Basically what Eddie's going to do is he's going to start mentally building a profile.
Awesome. As you continue to work your way down through, The methods of subdual look like they've changed. A couple of them were had some head trauma. Looks like they were probably busted on the back of the head with something, probably a lead pipe or a wrench or something. What was that?
So there were blitz attacks?
Blunt force.
By that, I mean, they like suddenly just, bam, rather than lure them somewhere, they just came out of the shadows and popped them.
In the early sections, yes. Yeah. The later ones had elevated levels of ketamine or assorted other animal tranquilizers. It looks like whoever's doing this, they're using it, whatever means of acquiring their victims, as looks like it would work on individual victims. The earlier ones were absolutely like pounce, blitz, violence things. Some of the later ones look like it's possible that they had drugs slipped to them, or it could have been more of a consensual thing. That's hard to tell from the autopsy.
Consensual up to a point.
Well, yeah. Well, yes. It could be determined like where are the needles? I mean, if it's like in the back of somebody's neck or whatever, like it's probably not consensual. But if it's like, where do you put ketamine in your body? I'm sure I've done it a shitload.
I think ketamine's taken orally. I'm pretty sure.
I know it's powder, like, well, in real life, I know you can get it in powder form. But, okay. But I don't know, like.
And that would be correct then, yes.
A lot of ketamine.
Yeah, white privilege has taken ketamine. Not Rob. I have never taken ketamine. Just to make that clear.
I think Rob protests too much.
So with what I'm seeing, does it look like as the person or persons basically evolved their quote craft, does it look like it's gone from like desperation to like actual like calm stalking, or does it look like the people doing this are rather than like stalking their victims, does it just look like does it feel like they're just random instead? Like, or can we assume that at least after the first three, they've started actually like watching their victims first?
It looks like after the first three that the victims are being more carefully selected as to how long they're watching before they get an opportunity. That you can't really tell from the reports, but it does look like victims are being much more carefully selected at this point. If nothing else, just by the degree of success that they haven't had further oopsies in terms of having grabbed somebody that didn't have a node.
Hey. So on the node, and I think this is where I'm curious. If we can't detect the node,
mm-hmm.
Whoever's doing the surgery knew exactly where to go. They knew what to look for. That's a level of information that, how would they have had?
Autopsies on Novas who have died have made it, it's publicly known, well, it's known to science and medicine at the very least, where in the brain the node is. So if the node exists, anybody with a little bit of training would know if it's going to be there, it's going to be right there.
Okay, so yeah. So this isn't something, though, that, you know, they would have required a certain amount of, like, access to info. They wouldn't have needed, like, top secret clearance to have gotten that kind of information.
Not top secret clearance, no, but a certain degree of medical understanding, yes. Though that doesn't necessarily imply like an actual doctor. I mean, you could potentially learn that via independent research, but no, it's not a top secret thing. Anybody that really put their mind to it could figure that out.
Okay.
Do the wounds to the heads signify any actual like medical knowledge?
Well, the ones that were just sawn open, not so much, but but the more recent ones, it looks like whoever's doing this has gotten a lot more careful and perhaps even, dare I say, skilled in terms of accessing the more recent victims. Buddy Clark and Suzanne Akins, their wounds actually do look to be almost surgical, and the removal of the node didn't disturb the surrounding brain tissue at all, other than, you know, from like the clipping of like the blood vessels and whatnot that feed the node. So definitely whoever's doing these later, either they've gotten somebody else to help them that has a clue as to what they're doing, or whoever has rapidly improved their skills.
They went from crude to almost skilled in a month.
Correct.
They
hired somebody.
Yeah, that implies right. either a couple of people or a Nova, a highly intelligent one.
With the most recent victims, with the wounds being surgical, could the person have survived that surgery if it were not for the blunt force trauma to the head?
Well, the most recent victims with the surgical strikes, they were actually drugged rather than having the blunt force trauma to the head.
Okay.
Like I say, it's not known whether a person could survive removal of the node, but mm-hmm. If, say, for example, there had been a brain tumor in the same position, the person would likely have stood at least a tolerable chance of survival.
Okay, so the drugs, I'm guessing that the drugs were enough that they were just dead. Like, could the surgery have been post-mortem, or would the person have been alive during the surgery and then they just deliberately shot them with more... with more anesthetic in order to just stop their hearts or something.
That would be intelligence medicine.
Yeah. Give it a try.
Okay. Hey, look, dice. The first roll of the game.
Dice Hooray. Rolls. You like dice rolls.
We do. Oh, there's my dice. I was just like, where are my dice? No,
I ate them. So I came over to your house and I ate them.
Well, keep in mind, if you have any mega intelligence, those dots count as well.
I do not have mega intelligence. Yeah, so I got two dice.
I believe in you.
Two Come dice. On,
do tens explode or are tens two in this one as well?
I'm willing to leave that up to y'all. Do y'all? Technically they explode, but I kind of like just counting. No, wait. And this is they still do count as two. Tens are two. Okay. Yeah, tens are two.
I got a nine.
Seven cool. above.
Seven and above. Yes.
Yep. I also got three successes.
Awesome.
I got one success.
Hey, Amanda, okay.
Hey, Garet.
Instead of intelligence medicine, could you tell me, and I don't know how academics is treated in this game, mm-hmm. would you treat academics just like the academic knowledge itself, whereas medicine is more specialized?
Medicine is more specialized. You could potentially, I mean, academics is basically book learning. That isn't covered by any of these other things like computer or engineering or medicine or science or whatnot.
But reading the reports, would I be able to use like intelligence academics for understanding what I'm looking at?
Oh, yeah, totally. Absolutely.
Okay.
Also investigation.
Yeah, investigation is also a good choice.
Oh, then I'll use investigation. Would that be still intelligence or would that be perception since investigation is a perception ability?
Investigations. Go ahead.
So the skills that are below their respective attributes are basically almost like specialties of them, but they can still be used with any other attribute depending on the ST. So like,
okay.
It would still be intelligence investigation.
Yeah.
Donka.
Okay.
Yeah. The attribute that they fall under is what most commonly gets used, but if you've got a good excuse for doing something else, yeah, it works.
Right. So intelligence medicine, I got one success.
Excellent.
And then Advent got three successes. And then
yes.
You said intelligence investigation for
what Garet got two.
For lightweight.
All right. Okay, well, with one success, you're able to figure out that the just from how from the toxicity levels in the blood at the time of the autopsy, that the ketamine had mostly cycled out to the point that probably the ketamine was used to subdue the person and to take them into, you know, to take them into wherever it was that this procedure was going to be done.
Right. They were basically roofied.
Basically, yes. That the amount that was still in the body at the point of death was not sufficient to have killed them.
Got it.
So whether the act of removing the node itself killed them or whether they just didn't bother to, because the wounds and all weren't closed.
Right.
The body's been found with a gaping head wound. So, I mean, that in and of itself probably would have killed them, whether the node, whether they would have survived the node removal or not.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Right. Two successes from Garet that lets you know that it would take a massive, massive overdose of ketamine to actually kill somebody. That, yes, it's a horse trank, but it's... you'd have to go out of your way to do it. An accidental overdose to the point of death is not hugely likely. But also, with you coming at this from the more academic perspective or for the investigation type stuff, that's also going to let you know that whoever's coming at this, they definitely had at least an academic understanding of what they were looking for, whether or not they themselves were medical staff. They clearly have done some research. They're coming at this from a highly skilled perspective. And like what adversary suggested, that they're either a highly intelligent...
I am not that NPC.
Nope, you're right, my bad.
Yep.
Yes.
I know they have similar letters, but damn.
Very similar names, but damn. Yeah. My bad.
One is a bad person, one is a countdown to chocolate.
That's indeed. Right. Yes, Advent. Yes. Okay. Yes, you're either dealing with a highly intelligent Nova or a crew, possibly both. And then Advent had three successes. It looks like, from what you can tell, this almost certainly had at least two people involved in the procedure, just based on what you don't see, because you've got the head trauma, but you don't actually see anything else on the body other than like whatever minor like cuts and bruises or scrapes or whatnot that a person would have from day-to-day life. So it looks like they weren't restrained or mistreated or abused or what have you in any way other than to have been subdued, probably put onto a table and had their brain screwed with. They weren't like beaten or like handcuffed or anything else like that. It looked like this whole thing was pretty smooth.
Well, and even down to, you know, having someone, you know, sucking away blood with during surgery.
Yep.
They probably had a second pair of hands.
At least. Yeah.
Also, it takes somebody ridiculously strong to move a limp body.
True. Or multiple people.
Okay.
So I have to ask this question. What do we think that they're doing with the node? Yes, they could be turned into drugs. I mean, what year is this set in right now? Like contemporary?
Yeah, let's go ahead and just say that it's...
Oh, I think we should play 2009.
Okay. Does anybody object?
I don't mind.
I don't have any objection.
Because I like the little bit of olderness of it. I mean, if you guys are insistent, I don't care. But
as long as we aren't getting hung up on what is historically accurate.
No, I don't care. It's kind of hard to do that because Novas have greatly changed the face of the planet and technology jumped real quick, real fast.
I just want to make sure things were a little hazy for me in 2009.
Same. No worries.
Just coming out of a haze.
Fair enough. Same.
It's cool. All right. It's 2009. Cool.
Well, I don't know. I just remember that TV show Heroes, and you had the one guy who kept eating the parts of the brain of the other heroes and getting their
power. That's exactly what I was thinking.
Yeah.
It wasn't that he was eating them. It was the fact that he was like the clockmaker's clockmaker's son, and he was opening the brain to look at it,
But
either way, he was still. I remember that TV show. So I'm wondering somebody trying to take what they're.
So to get back to my initial hypothesis of drugs, this is what I mean: that perhaps that somebody is taking these things and using them to gain some sort of high of sorts, give them superpowers like we have.
It's not
that's something we should look into for sure.
It is definitely something that can be a possibility. I know that there is the might that comes from the Nova's hormonal secretions, and there's the much more problematic soma that actually does come from the node tissue of dead Novas. But I can't begin to think, well, I suppose it's possible that something similar to soma could be made from these nodes, even if they have not properly expressed themselves yet. To my knowledge, such a thing has never been studied. Who would even have considered such a thing would be possible before now?
Yeah, crazy that anybody would consider something like that possible, like 20 minutes ago when I mentioned it.
My apologies for doubting you, Mr. White Privilege.
Apology accepted.
It's also possible that perhaps they want to try to synthetically create a node so that they could somehow find a way to implant it into their brain or into the brain of someone else in order to manufacture a Nova rather than...
It is certainly possible, and discovering the motive would, I believe, go a great deal towards eventually finding our perpetrators.
Yeah, so I'm going to be really honest. Before my eruption, I was just a construction worker. I'm not much in the way of an investigator. So, like, while I have some ideas as to where we can go with this, like, maybe you could give us some direction as to where to start. Like,
well, the files that we've provided you, and these are copies that you're more than welcome to retain for your perusal as you see fit. Our originals remain here, of course, but these are full copies for your use. They contain the addresses and contact information and all of the details on these individuals. As far as that goes, granted, the crime scenes all at this point have been thoroughly examined and gone over, but there's certainly no reason that y'all could not also investigate those. Y'all may very well find something that my staff have missed, though they are good, solid employees and very good cops. They are not Novas, so I could not begin to comprehend some of the things that y'all might be able to bring to bear on this investigation. As far as your own personal skills, Mr. Advent, I can only begin to imagine that even if you do not have specific forensic or investigative training, we are going to need all possible opportunities available to us to catch and confine these individuals and bring them to justice. And, well, my team of regular police officers, well, should these individuals turn out to be highly powerful Novas, there is not a great deal they can do to stop them.
Let me take a look at all this stuff. Here, hand it over.
The piles of files.
All right, so I just lay everything out in front of me, and I walk around. I just walk down and look at it. Kind of look down at it, lean over it. I'd like to use my luck.
Go for it.
Good times.
How do I use? I mean, I know it says I can use my luck, but it influences something else. So do I use another ability and then luck is added to it, or do I just roll luck?
So if I remember right, and I can look it up if necessary, but I'm pretty sure you would just roll like intelligence investigation or perception investigation and then add your luck dots to it. But let's find out. Let's double check.
Yeah, let's find out.
Yeah, it's not. I just read it just because it's on page 206 of the core book. And I just read it and it's not like super clear. It says you can ask for all your luck.
Each dot of luck adds one success, not one die, to any use of abilities outside of combat. If a character makes two or more ability checks during the same time frame or a minute, you got to divide your luck. So like you'll roll your perception or intelligence plus investigation, and every dot of luck you get, you have adds a success, not a dice. So you automatically get those as successes. And if you have any...
All right, so I got a total of 6 successes then.
Oof, good Lord. Okay.
So I'm like literally just like walking over and like, I don't know, like just picking shit up. Like, I don't look like I know what I'm doing at all. Like, not even a little bit. Like,
that is the best.
At one point, I probably pick up a Chinese food menu that like one of the detectives left out. Like, examine it closely. I mean, I'm just like totally randomly looking at you.
And at this point, Crash is so used to this crap that she pulls out a knife and she's picking brown flecks out from under her nails. Could be dry blood, could be dirt. We're not going to ask questions.
Yep.
I can see now. He looks at the menu and just tosses it aside. It lands on what he needs.
Yeah.
Yeah, that could be.
I like it. So yeah, you flip the menu and it actually lands. It's one of those like trifold menus, and it actually lands upright on the fold so that the point of the fold is pointing at the Boyd Speedway spot on the map that's laid out.
Now, this is interesting. I like going to this. Tell me about this place, Boyd Speedway.
Well, that would be our... highly popular sprint car racing establishment. The two bodies that were located were actually in a field just behind the speedway rather than on the speedway themselves. No doubt they would have been located a bit more quickly had they been on the speedway themselves, as opposed to likely to have been run over. But the Mr. Randall Allen and Mr. Hiram McDowell were both of those bodies were dumped behind the speedway. They were more than likely dumped somewhere around the 18th or 19th of January, though they were not discovered until the 23rd. We base that 18th or 19th on the amount of decomposition and, the wildlife had been at them.
Well, I think we should go over there and check it out.
Sounds like a good place to start as any.
I will leave that entirely in y'all's very capable hands. Good luck and Godspeed.
Chief Murphy, before you go, can I get the contacts for the officers who've been running lead on this?
Their cards are each clipped onto the files. As far, yes.
Sorry.
each of the officers who were the original point of contact, as well as Officer Martinez, who is our primary point of contact with the investigation as a whole.
Okay. And Amanda, would I know any of these people? Would I have talked to them? Would I have bumped into them? Would we have had some kind of task force or something? Or not really?
You're probably... most of the ones that were like the ones that just found the bodies and were the first on scene, probably not. Chattanooga has a rather large force and they tend to do some turnover. But you are familiar with Officer Martinez. He's been a detective for about 5 years. He's considered to be somewhat of an up-and-comer. He's not quite fast-tracked, but people are keeping an eye on him, expecting him to do great things. This almost feels like a test for him, that he's been put in charge of this investigation, as much to see what he does with it as to get this done. Because at this point, they've realized that it's going to take Nova help, but they're still like looking at him for how he's going to deal with this in terms of his career moving forward.
Yeah, Hughes will see Martinez's card. Oh, Martinez! I didn't know he was running point on this. Wonder why he wasn't part of this meeting.
He is currently out with the flu.
Shit, I'll have to send him some kind of edible arrangement or whatever the hell you do for those things. All right. Thanks.
Very well. If y'all have any questions, once Martinez gets back into the office, then he will be your primary point of contact. But until then, you have my number.
Is that public knowledge that he's the primary contact? Primary lead investigator?
It was, I believe, listed in the paper, yes.
Maybe send a patrol to his house and make sure he's okay.
Certainly, I'll be more than happy to do that. That would seem to be, well, I'll send someone out right away.
Since we're not getting any drugs, and we've got a place to go,
shall we?
Let's be on with it, shall we?
Sure thing.
Do we have enough? Do we have any cars that all of us could go in at once, or do we want to meet there? I mean, I have an Escalade.
Unfortunately, it's my job to drive with Alex here, so.
It's your job to drive yourself. And I take a couple of steps over towards like a window and I jump out and fly away. Fly to the place.
Okay. Well, that's something to make a note of.
All Eddie does is he kind of flexes his jaw and you hear a slight pop. And he goes, okay, shall we? And he just...
Sure. Why not?
I mean, is there any douchier superpower than flight? I mean, I just couldn't think of anything douchier.
Flight is. It's great. That's kind of great.
It's the power of probability is making sure he doesn't land on the ground as a red smear. That's the power of his luck.
Can I ride with one of you?
Yeah, come on.
I'll be going with you, but just give me a minute. And Crash pulls out the spare key to Alex's car and drives it a few blocks over under some trees, so it's a little harder for him to find.
I would like to point out that when we leave the chief's office, a light bulb explodes. Just
okay. She glances up. Better make a note to have that replaced.
All right, so
people. All right. Yeah. Boyd Speedway is over outside of East Ridge, which is a bedroom community of Chattanooga. It's between the map and those of you who are more familiar with the area, y'all know where it is. It's one of the, if you're the kind of person who likes car racing, it's a pretty big deal in the area. And this being in the early afternoon, yeah, there are some people working at the speedway itself. There's some folks time testing, people working on cars and whatnot. However, like I said, the actual bodies were discovered in a field behind the speedway, so you can avoid the speedway entirely if that's what you see fit. White privilege has absolutely gotten there significantly faster going overland as the crow flies than y'all will by car. So privilege, what if anything do you want to do while you're, or you're making a pit stop even before you get there?
Yeah, is there like a bar at this place?
There's a concessions stand. Yeah, beer. Yeah, get some beer.
There's a Best Western nearby, Rob. There's tons of yeah, hotels.
Oh yeah, there are plenty of places. I mean, the thing on site is a concession stand, but you can there are plenty of bars and hotels and restaurants and actual liquor stores in the immediate area. Yeah.
So I'm going to, like, while I'm waiting for everybody, I'm going to get them all food, but I'm going to get them what I assume poor people eat.
Oh, shit.
No. So, like, I don't know what I would actually eat in real life. Like some hot, like, I don't know, like the most disgusting, like nacho-y thing with like chili and cheese all over it. And, like all that kind of stuff.
Awesome.
Like I look around for like people that I think look just like them, which are like people with like, you know, their sleeves cut off and like beer bellies and stuff. And I just like get them poor people.
Poor people food. Awesome.
Awesome. Is that in quotation marks? Poor people food.
Oh, White Rose is going to feel real weird when he finds out that Eddie's rich.
Excellent. Yes, yeah, so you have plenty of time to stock up on poor people food by the time that the others get there. And so you're just waiting with your spread?
Yeah.
Beautiful. Okay, awesome. Well, I don't know if any of y'all have ever actually been to a racetrack.
Yep.
Well, yeah, you. I figured you would, because you're redneck boy.
Well, I mean, I lived in Nashville, and I know Chattanooga.
There you go. Yeah, it's a big honking oval. It's got bleachers on the one side. It's got all of the pit crew and areas for the folks who are actually doing the racing. And there's
the human hamster wheel.
Yes. Yes. We are going to watch everybody turn left a lot. And there's a dirt access road that goes around behind the speedway that, you know, from the files is actually the closest access to where the bodies were found. And indeed, once y'all pull around and back, you do, in fact, see Mr. White Privilege in his white clothing just there with his spread of poor people food.
I mean, and there's a lot. Like, a lot of food.
Yeah. Which Nophas do, in fact, have huge appetites unless they took the adaptability enhancement. Nophas eat, like, four times as much as regular people. Just in general.
Hmm.
Since I got here early, I took the liberty of ordering all of your favorites.
Right.
You know what?
I also look like I've eaten the thing.
My character is 20. My character is 24. Not hasn't been out of college. Sure. Thanks.
Mainly to be polite, Eddie takes one nacho, eats it, goes, "Thank you. Thank you kindly."
Hughes is actually like looking around trying to look for security cameras, any kind of CCTV or something that would be for this area, and then he'll kind of glance at the food, do a double take, and just sort of, "Oh, sure, I'll get to it in a second." Let's see.
Awesome. Perception, either awareness or investigation.
Perception, awareness or investigation. Let's see how that go.
Looking for cameras.
Perception, awareness, or investigation. So both of those are a six dice pool. So one, two, three.
I would like to assist, but also even though it's not one of the techniques I can use, I would like to use my particular Nova power to feel them out.
Is it possible to assist? Is that something you can do? I forget in this game.
Well, not like D&D. You'd be doing your own role and all of our successes would be pulled together if we're all helping each other.
Right.
Okay, I'll do that then too.
Good Lord, we got a 2 and a 5.
What is it? It's what? What's this? What are the combinations?
Perception and either awareness or investigation.
I got 1. You would roll 5 dice.
I got 7. 7 or higher.
Where?
Also, I found my math rocks, so I don't have to use the app because the app was being really weird.
Okay.
All right. And I had 2 successes as well.
1 for me.
Excellent. All right. Okay, cool. Well, with 1 success, anybody who got 1 success is able to readily pick out the security cameras that are inward focused towards the track. The majority of those being to watch the track and its immediate environs, though it's possible if those have audio pickup, they wouldn't have picked up anything visually, but if they also had audio pickup and there had been noises connected with the event, then that might have happened. 2 successes also shows the same thing. And then we had 5 and 7, is that correct?
Correct.
Excellent. All right. 5 successes. You actually pick out where, like, indentations in the ground, that where it looks like a tripod was set up at one point. So even though there aren't any actual security cameras set up here, it looks like a camera was set up temporarily and then taken away, or something else on a tripod. I mean, I suppose it could be a surveying tripod or something, but there shouldn't really be tripods set up in this area. And Eddie was doing his, you are aware of all of the electronics coming out of the Speedway area. You're also aware that there is a buried cable line running under this area, though that's probably not connected with, I mean, it's probably just a buried power line. Yeah. Yeah, it's probably just a power line. And you also are aware that yeah, that's a satellite.
Since I know where all the cameras are, that means I know where the surveillance room is.
Yeah, totally.
Oh, the surveillance room's over there, and he just starts walking.
I literally just leave the food behind too, like.
Hey, he'll pick up like one of the bat things and like munch on it while he goes, because, you know, why not? But
there's an entire table just covered with food and he just like wastes it, just leaves it there.
Okay.
Beautiful you people. Awesome. Okay, so everybody's going to the surveillance room or
tour,
or y'all hanging out here?
Lightweight is going to, as we're leaving the table, and since the food's just going to be left there, if there's any workers around, he'd be like, yo, feel free to take some of this so it doesn't go to waste, please.
Awesome. And foop.
God. If I see that, just a knowing shake of my head, throwing crumbs to the poor people.
Bread and circuses. Gotta love it.
That's not, man.
I love hate white privilege.
I do too. I actually am feeling kind of bad playing this character. Like, there's something inside my soul that feels so wrong.
I mean, I like to play the better as the campaign goes through it.
Okay, cool.
Character growth is a thing. It'll be fun.
Who knows? He might actually learn to be a person.
Rich.
Yeah. All right. So yeah, y'all head over to the electronics maintenance surveillance security. That's the right word. Security room. It's locked, but y'all can readily find an employee. There are plenty of people wandering around doing employee things.
Hey there, we need to speak to a manager about the surveillance room. I'm Agent Hughes with the CPD.
Kind of leans in to scrutinize your badge a little bit. Okay, hang on a second. I'll get
Thanks.
Bobby.
Okay.
He tobacco spits, wanders off.
Charming.
I know we don't want to break the door, but while they're awake, can I just pick it?
Probably.
Actually, Amanda, I messaged you. I'm just going to walk through the door and unlock it.
That works.
Huh. Sure. Okay. Actually, no, I do want to talk to the manager, but I'll keep him distracted. Okay. I see how this is going to go. Got it.
I go to pick.
I mean, lives are at stake here. What are we waiting around for?
I would think Tom would be excited that we didn't, you know, push the door down. But, you know, who wants to do it my way?
Go ahead.
I think that time is coming.
Go ahead and do your density thingy there, Garet.
Okay. Let me look at the mechanics on that, because I
think that I can do it.
Might very well be.
Yeah, because I'm not trying to resist anything. It's not a contested action, so that's...
Yeah, okay. That's not a roll. So you just do it and you just go through pass through the door. Awesome. Cool. All right. Yeah, you are through the door. And once you're through the door, it's just a simple knob turn door lock with a deadbolt or with a deadbolt on the inside, so you flip them open, no worries.
Yep.
Okay, cool. And y'all are in.
I don't know computers that well, but I know engineering. Is there anything I can do to start doing the thing? Or does anybody know how to do this thing better than me?
I can work with computers.
Sounds like this is a job for you.
Amanda, is this intelligence computers or is this, would it be something else?
Intelligence computers if you're wanting to compute.
Yep.
What's the room look like?
It's about 10 feet square. It's got one of those L-shaped desks. It's got one actual computer and a massive bank of surveillance camera TV feeds. There's also a microphone that looks like it's hooked up to a PA system. One of the other walls is covered in gear, like safety vests and a couple of hard hats with flashlights on the front of them, bunches of other flashlights. Oddly enough, a huge bucket of those zip ties that you use for handcuffing drunk white people in there when they're being at the races. Huge bucket of those. yeah.
Three successes, Amanda.
Excellent. All right. There is a password on the computer, but it doesn't mind you being there and you get past it without any real difficulty. I'm sure the manager will be thrilled with that.
Boyd's B-Ray 123.
Yeah.
Password.
Password.
Yeah. Password turned out to be Vroom Vroom.
VR0OM, VR0OM.
Yeah.
Now, as he's going, like him dicking around with the computer, is it like looking at the monitor, the bank of screens, does it look like there's, like, we know where the bodies were found outside of the Speedway, but does it look like this might, you know, I mean, like maybe we can hone in on like what is the likeliest cameras to be in that region if somebody were like dragged out there or, you know, nearby there or something like that?
You could easily pick out the camera that would be the closest to it. And there's also a separate camera that is monitoring the dirt access road. So if somebody came in using the road, they would definitely have been picked up on camera that way. And the camera that was actually closest to the site, like I say, it wouldn't have picked up anything visually unless coming in from the road, but it is possible that there would be some audio, maybe. Yeah, that was a complete thought. Okay, excellent. So yeah, Garet got in with three successes. Excellent. And you're able to scroll back. The way that these cameras are set up, they automatically dump their footage after every 3 days. But because this thing happened, there are files that have been put aside in a separate folder, and you're sure that the cops have copies of them. But there is a folder marked January 23rd, I think it was.
23, yeah.
Yeah, 23rd. There is a folder marked January 23rd files.
Perfect.
Okay, the 23rd, not the 18th or 19th?
Well, the folder's marked 23rd as to what's in it. Yeah.
Gotcha.
I'll take a look at that, the 23rd file.
What most day is it right now?
It is, I think that we had originally planned on doing this on February 4th, so it's February 4th.
Boy, how time flies. Yes. Kind of like a stuck up white dude.
Zing.
Yeah. So yeah, just reviewing the files on from February 23rd, you get remarkably high quality video of first one cop car and then three more cop cars and then the CSI van and then an ambulance and then the coroner truck all coming down the access road in turn. And several hours later, them straggling out as they were no longer needed.
But nothing from before all the hubbub?
I need somebody with cyber.
The bodies were discovered after it was likely that the video was already deleted because it auto deletes after 3 days.
Right.
Right. I was just...
I wonder if there's anything on the video. I'll say, lightweight. He's, anybody on the video there looking like they're watching things or taking, victim, the criminal comes back to the crime, that whole thing, that kind of cliche. You guys know, do the investigation thing.
Amanda, can I do perception and investigation as I'm actually going through the video on what's there? Because it's one thing to watch it, but it's another thing to try and kind of like
pull go for
stuff
it.
Out of it.
Go for it.
I'm actually wanting to, while he's doing that, also pay attention and see if I can actually pick out somebody like paying special attention in the crowd.
Excellent. We'll see what Garet comes up with as far as his detailed role, but even just looking at it, there is a small crowd that, geez, I think you're playing Exalted. All right, six successes, cool. what y'all can tell just obviously is that a small crowd, it looks like mostly employees gathered right at the edges of like where the camera cut off. It looks like they were like, that was the as close as they were allowed to go to watch what was going on. And they were looky-looing as far as, hey, look, some people got, there's bodies dumped here and there's all these cops. But with six successes, good Lord, Lightweight is able to you know, okay, obviously these folks there, I mean, most of them have, you know, Boyd Speedway t-shirts on. They're obviously supposed to be there. And there are some other folks that are just trackheads that just, they have that sort of innate, easy familiarity with the track that would indicate they're here all the time, no matter what. But yeah, there's that one stringy kid that really does not look like he belongs here. He's in the crowd with the others, but he didn't really strike you as the kind that would normally hang out at a racetrack, especially when there's not actually a race going.
I'll point that out to Agent Hughes and ask who, if he has a way of figuring out who this kid is.
I'm not actually there. I'm supposed to be running interference with, you decided to be here and I'm with that dude.
Yeah. At this point, by the time that Lightweight has run all of these videos, the manager has in fact come up to y'all, keys at the ready, only to find Agent Hughes.
Hey there, Agent Hughes with the Chattanooga Police Department. I'd like to ask you a few questions. These are follow-ups concerning the bodies that were found on the 23rd.
I already answered everything I thought, but I'll do it again for you.
Were you the manager on site at the when the bodies were discovered?
Yeah.
And has anybody spoken with you concerning maybe the January the 18th or the 19th, who might have been on schedule then, who might have been working at the track?
Well, I was on schedule for the 8th. I'm on pretty much every night, especially when there's a race going. So that would have been me at the same time, though once the track closes for the evening. It's the same accent. No.
Shush. Less Southern Belle, more hick.
Oh, shut up.
Kind of blends in.
It's okay. I don't judge you.
I judge me. Yeah. So once the track closes down for the night, I don't tend to stay all that much longer after that.
Anybody hanging around to where I said anybody?
You're breaking up, Howard.
Why is he
robot? You sound like you're a robot in Hillman.
Dang it.
You're a robot.
Okay, so
short,
yeah. Okay, hang on. Okay, hold on a second.
I'm just glad it's not Rob and I, because we're the ones usually having problems. Online and in real life.
Any better?
Yep.
I think much. So. Yes, much better.
Okay.
Yay.
There we go.
Cool.
All right. So any regulars, any new faces that how long do you keep your footage for?
To the best of my knowledge, footage auto deletes every 3 days unless we copy it over. We copied over everything once the cops turned up and asked for it. But that we don't actually have a camera focus particularly on that patch of ground. It's just waste space. Can't really build much too close to a speedway. The noise gets on people's nerves.
You never thought of expanding?
Maybe we'll at some point. At this point, that's all for the shareholders, that kind of thing.
Gotcha.
Now, how did that door get open?
Crash goes on ahead and leans against the door jamb, crosses her arms over her chest, and looks over at him.
It was unlocked.
Slight snarl on her face, just waiting. She's been getting a little itchy.
Oh, dear.
Trying to intimidate.
Yeah. So, let's see.
Advent keeps just randomly looking up.
1, 6, 7. 3 successes. It's above a 6 or above a 7?
Above a 7.
7 up.
Okay, so 3.
Yeah, 7 or above. So yes, technically above a 6. All right. Okay, cool. Yeah, he looks over at you and decides that wondering why the door is unlocked is not conducive to his long-term health and well-being, and discontinues that particular line of questioning.
Smart man.
Amanda, would it have been possible for Hughes to read over the file for the Boyd Speedway on the way to the Boyd Speedway?
Sure. Yeah.
Okay. I am trying to figure out if there's anything, like, any actual follow-up questions I would be thinking of. I mean, I could do a roll if you need me to. Other than that, basically, I'm here distracting, but at the same time, it would be cool if I could get... if I could ask some questions that, like, were not covered in the reports.
Okay, hang on a second. I'm answering Travis momentarily.
Gotcha.
Okay, cool. I'm sorry, Howard. I was typing to Travis and... okay, there we go. There we go.
No, that's okay.
So, yeah, so I lost the thread of what you were asking me to do. My apologies.
Basically, I'm trying to figure out if there are questions I should be asking covered.
Gotcha.
Yeah, that weren't covered with the, like, especially any of the 18th to the 19th stuff. I don't know if there were, like, if anybody came back asking about the 18th, since that would have been...
Right. Bob tells you that, well, we had all of those cops out here on the 23rd, and they were... couple days later, that one fella, Martinez? Yeah. He came back out. He's thinking maybe those bodies had been here for a few days. So maybe 18th, maybe 19th, somewhere in there. We don't have a camera focused on that area. And by then, of course, the footage would already have been scrubbed. We didn't have any security incident that we know that we caught on anything. Like I said, we didn't have anything as far as the road or what have you. So more than likely, whoever dropped those bodies off, they did it on the quiet and probably late at night. Since we usually have folks out here on the track up to 1-2 in the morning most of the time. So they probably would have had to have been after that, but probably couldn't have really done it much before dawn. So in the wee hours, it'd be about the only time that they could have done it without being noticed.
Gotcha. Okay. Well,
I have a question.
Uh-huh.
It's got to be someone who just can't get away from the action. Is there anyone who just kind of lingers after hours, perhaps doesn't exactly have a home to go to, might be hunkered down somewhere nearby?
Well, we've got a couple of guys that we let. He kind of looks at Agent Hughes and looks back at Captain Intimidating over there. Looks back at Agent Hughes.
I'll spend a quantum for the voice. Go ahead and answer her question.
Oh yeah, the voice. I love it.
Like, I'm still Mr. Nobody, but I'm gonna just, I have tactful, but I'll go ahead and it's the voice rather than, like, giving orders or something, so.
Okay.
We're all friends here.
Well, I wouldn't. We've got a couple of folks that they sometimes do a little bit of cleaning up work for us. Not quite on the, they're more independent on the books. Contractors. Yeah, they work off the books. Not that we're doing anything that would be wrong, but sometimes it's better for people to not necessarily be able to have a direct paycheck, especially if they already don't have a bank account.
Just get to the point.
Yeah, they're just like my maids. Go on.
It's all right. Take your time.
Jerry and Alan, I don't know where they stay, but they got to stay somewhere around here. They walk over here when they've got time to do some work for us.
Advent sidles over next to Lightweight and kind of leans in and says, how good are you with the computers?
I'm decent. What do you need me to try and find?
There's a satellite above us. Can you access it?
I can try. Right. Amanda?
I also sit down and start typing.
Would that be intelligence?
That'd be in computers, yeah. Or you could try in engineering, but computers is probably the better option.
Yeah, I've got one, but not the other.
Okay.
Actually, he doesn't type. What he does is he sits down and he puts a hand on a keyboard.
Oh, God.
That's actually six successes. I rolled 2 10. I had 2 10s and 2 8s.
Let's see if we can see any surveillance.
I need Garrett's dice.
I know, right?
Wow. Okay.
So let's see if we can see if they.
Let me just computer into space from this computer at the security desk.
Right. Now, in all fairness,
raceway in Chattanooga.
That's actually why I put my hand on the thing. The way my successes help is I'm boosting the power.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, this being the low key like rig out that it is, Lightweight probably couldn't have done it from this computer without that boost. Yeah.
Suddenly the light gets bright in here. A
couple of light bulbs blow out. And in pictures start downloading. That satellite orbits every 90 minutes, give or take. And over the course of the next 10 minutes, y'all get the last like 2 weeks worth of pictures that it took on its every 90 minute pass.
Okay. I will happily take that.
Yeah.
And
I've seen that DM face on my own face.
1, 2, 3, 4.
I love it when the roles come together.
5.
That was candid. Y'all are delightfully 6. Horrible. Okay.
And that's 6 successes on perception and investigation. I'm going through the pictures looking to.
Oh, yeah, I'm going to do that too.
Interpret what I'm seeing.
I only got 2 on that one.
Oh, Lord. With you 2 just putting your heads together, I'm just going to, yeah.
By our powers combined, we are Captain Nuisance.
We lost Howard.
Yeah.
Uh-oh.
Yes. We will pause a moment and see if Howard
can. You want to take a break? If we're happening in the session, maybe it's a good time for a bio break.
Yes, please.
And for the record, my die, this is like rare. Normally it's Travis's die where he's rolling like 3 die and will still come up with 5 successes.
Yeah, it's bullshit.
Yes. All right, so I've got something for us while we're waiting here.
Okay. Look at it.
Here.
Your game is important to us. Please stand by.
Beautiful. Yes.
I also maintain, Amanda, if you ever need me to do like...
Your GM would like you to know that dice rolls performed in his absence will not be counted.
Yeah, I'll be right back.
I randomly sent Amanda a thing where I was doing a news.
Long bathroom breaks have been shown as an effective way of building anticipation in a role-playing game. The gods frown upon players who peek behind their GM screen. Yes, I will snitch on you. Your GM is temporarily unavailable. Please stand by. Wouldn't it be nice to refill your GM's drink right now? GMing is thirsty work. Your GM would like you to know that your next saving throw may very well be your last. And remember, if life hands you lemonade, kick it in the balls and say, I wanted a beer, bitch. Your game is important to us. Please stand by. Excessive dice rolling is a leading cause of repetitive stress injuries among gamers. Remember, don't sweat the small stuff. Gnomes, for example. After being in there this long, your GM is hungry. Feed the GM. Your game is important to us. Please stand by. Try not to step on the brownies. It's during long pauses such as these that we often grow philosophical and ponder the deeper questions of gaming. Just where did that tiger keep those 20 silver pieces? Is it really surprising there are no half-dwarfs? Where are the stats for were-hedgehogs? Would I get more girls if I played a bard? Do Italian vampires hate garlic? How will I lose my paladinship this time? Exactly what the heck is he doing in there this long? Where does one apply to become a Herald of Galactus? If I work for Department 7, what does Departments 1 through 6 do? Why didn't Gandalf cast more spells? Did he lose his spellbook or something? Your GM is temporarily unavailable. Please stand by.
So in the past, when I was younger, I dealt with a lot of body image issues. I used to be a little bit chubbier. That's where I get the nickname Kelly with the belly. And I used to jump in like swimming pools when we'd have pool parties with my t-shirt on because I was so insecure about my body. Back in the day, I really had no one to talk to. Luckily nowadays, I have BetterHelp. So whenever I'm dealing with an issue, I have someone I can talk to at the tip of my fingers. They offer custom online therapy that includes video, phone, and even live chat sessions with your therapist. So you don't even need to see anyone on camera if you don't want to. BetterHelp is more affordable than traditional offline therapy. You just need to fill out a questionnaire to help access your specific needs, and then you get matched with the therapist in under 48 hours. Then you can schedule some video and phone sessions, plus you can exchange unlimited messages. Also, you can request a new therapist at no additional charge anytime. Through BetterHelp, I've been learning a lot, and my therapist, Donald, has been telling me to appreciate the small things in life and just to be grateful for everyday things, which has really helped me mentally and gives me better perspective on life.
Yay! Oh, there's still some major distortion there, Howard.
I think that's the audio that I'm getting. Rob's playing, I thought, or I could be wrong. Oh. Oh, no, it is. Yeah, there is still distortion on Howard.
I was a little entertained. You know yourself, I normally don't get die rolls like this. It's like my dice are actually being, for those few rolls, were actually being, you know what it is, they like to roll high when it's something that furthers a plot. When it's stuff that I want to do just because I want to do it, the dice go, You wanted to do that that you thought was going to be really cool, but we say no. I thought the music that Rob has playing, when there was a section where it was talking, and it had something that I thought about you. It said, what are the stats for a were-hedgehog?
Spiky.
I saw a video on Twitter yesterday of a guy giving a hedgehog a bath.
Aren't they adorable?
So he's like, I'm like, that poor thing is like being shaken all over the place. But the hedgehog just looked kind of like, just chill about it. I mean, it did not look nonplussed.
Nope. And they're so adorable when they just paddle around in the sink. I need a hedgehog. I need kitties.
Testing.
You're there, but it didn't sound right.
Yeah.
Okay.
Oh, no. That sounded a little bit better.
Testing, testing.
There we go. You got it.
Yeah.
Awesome.
Okay. That music is really loud.
Yes, it is.
Yeah, it's hard to turn it down.
Yeah. Nope. There we go. Yes.
Did your internet decide to just go kablooey?
Basically, and what's happening is that now I'm using a hotspot.
That's clever.
Yeah, my phone can do a hotspot, or though,
That's way louder than it was when it first started. So, but when it first started, it was more of a different music that was playing.
Yeah. I suspect that it's a playlist and that Rob and Gretchen have stepped away.
Grammarly's tone suggestions can offer a more personable approach to win over a big client. Make a big impact on your team's success. With Grammarly, click the blue button to download Grammarly today.
So the only thing that I've got is Jerry and Alan, who are regulars who work off the books. They walk to the track.
Yep. They're okay, more than like, so. the implication was that they were homeless and lived in the area.
Gotcha.
Yeah.
Got it. I found Cheez-Its.
Cheez-Its are delicious.
Okay. And then there were the satellite feed was downloading, so I'm guessing, yep. Yeah, so.
Excellent. Awesome. Okay, we got everybody back. Yes, good. Yay. Cool.
Back to our currently scheduled program.
Folks, I'm sorry, my computer ate the file that I had about the with the details of each of the victims, so I'll have that rewritten and available for you next session. Just FYI. Okay, cool.
Bad hungry computer.
Indeed. All right, so Bob the manager tells you that Jerry and Alan, they're here most nights, and we give them what work we can. Feed them out of the concession stand, and they got to live somewhere around here. It's not like they can go all that much far. If they come in tonight, I'll be more than happy to send them your way. I don't know if they'll be in.
If they've got a way of, I don't know if they have burner phones or anything like that, but please feel free to pass my card to them, and I give them my business card. It's got the cell phone, like it's got the official number, and it's got a cell phone on the back.
I'll pass the word to him. He kind of glances over at Crash again. Just be sure to lock up when you're finished, if that's all right, unless you need me for anything else. I'll just leave y'all to it then.
You'll be in your office?
I'll be in my office.
All right.
Backs away, keeping an eye on Crash. No sudden moves.
Thank you, sir.
Y'all do what you need to do. Have a good day. Yeah.
You too.
Yeah.
Thank you again, sir.
Thank you. And about that point, the images have finished downloading, and I'm sure that one of y'all has a chip drive or something to copy them all off on with no problem. The overwhelming majority of them are trashed. I mean, it's satellite pictures from a couple of weeks. I mean, there's a bunch of pictures, but you could easily sort through and find the ones that you want. And what you find on the 18th was three people. One of them, of course, this being satellite imagery, it's all, you know, top down. So you're looking at the tops of people's heads and what's going on. So you're not seeing faces or anything.
Enhance. In the television shows, it's like it just completely de-digitizes them so you can see exactly who it is.
I mean, it might actually work for Mr. White Privilege. You never know.
Actually, it might. Yeah, fine.
No, I mean, I don't have any special skills.
You got no special skills whatsoever. Just luck.
There's also the irony that, you know, there is the irony that, you know, satellites from space can get a better image of the ground than a camera above a door in a store.
Yeah.
Keeping in mind, this would have been 2009 also. So,
true. Okay. So, yeah, what you've got there, there are a half dozen pictures showing more or less the same thing as the satellite fires off an image. Yeah, every like 90 seconds or so. But what you've got there is three people. One of them is of average build. And he's the one that actually has both what y'all can clearly tell are bodies rolled up in plastic, one over each shoulder.
That's strong.
Yeah.
That shows either. If he's average build, that shows mega strength.
More than likely, yes. Okay. He's wearing gloves, but he's also just wearing jeans and a long sleeve flannel shirt. And you know, like rubber gloves, like not like medical gloves, but like dishwashing gloves. And he's got one plastic wrap body on each shoulder. And there's a woman who she's got long black hair and she looks small, not like little person small, but petite. She doesn't actually seem to be doing anything. So like supervising or directing, just, I mean, she's not carrying or anything. But she is with him. And then there's an old guy who's looks like early 70s, maybe, skinny, a little bit hunched over. He's got a cane. And it obviously there's no video or sound. These are still pictures, but as the pictures are sequential, they come onto frame from deeper out into the waste area. So it's clear that they didn't come in from the road at all. And the first shot shows them advancing over the broken ground in the waste area. And by the time the next shot comes down, the guy with the bodies is in the process of, he's got one that he's in the process of rolling the body off of his shoulder onto the ground. And the other body is already onto the ground next to it. And the next picture shows the woman. She has a box cutter and she's slitting the plastic wrap on the bodies. And the next picture shows the strong guy almost doing the tablecloth trick, you know, where you woof the tablecloth out from under the dining, the tableware. Yeah.
Ta-da!
The next picture shows him like making a ball out of the plastic wrap, and the final picture shows the three of them making their way back in the same direction that they came from, deeper into the scrub area.
So they were dumped here.
They were dumped, yeah. And the plastic wrap that was brought in was taken away with them. But yeah, with white privileges enhancement, you do have pretty decent images of all three faces.
Okay.
Yeah.
From the direction they came from and went back to, is that near, is that towards a road, or is it into the woods, or
did it was into the woods. I mean, it's not like deep woods, but it's like second growth scrublands for like noise cancellation. It's not like forest, but yeah.
Who wants to go for a hike? Just me? Okay.
I know one of us just fly there.
Sorry, I didn't realize mine was muted. I'd go with, because we can't, he's carrying two bodies. So he's also a nobody. Mm-hmm.
Most likely.
Ronnie is, yeah.
Amanda, the guy carrying, that's not the one that I saw in the picture, in the...
No. Totally different. The guy that you saw in the picture, he looks like he's maybe 18, 19, buck 20 soaking wet. I mean, with a, if he were a Nova, that wouldn't matter, but definitely not the same person.
All right. Well, I'm gonna head that way and see what I find out that way.
Yeah, I'll fly over. I look really fucking good doing it too, by the way. I have mega appearance, so.
That's good times.
And I have just 5 appearance. So I'm like.
Yeah, you're a pretty white boy.
Really, really ridiculously good looking.
Beautiful. Okay, cool.
What time is it?
Change your name.
What time is it when, while we're there?
Y'all were called into the police at about 2. So it's probably about 3:30, maybe 4.
Okay.
Yeah, you've got probably another hour's worth of solid daylight before it starts to get dark.
Gotcha.
Yeah. I mean, yeah. Okay. Yeah. I mean, even then, I mean, there are plenty of flashlights in the security hut, so darkness isn't necessarily a huge problem anyway.
Well, and Chattanooga is also on the cusp of Central and Eastern time, so.
True. Yeah. And damn, if that's not confusing as hell to live there. Hey, all right. So is anybody not going out into the woods?
I kind of hope Crash comes with, because we run into that strong guy, strong person versus strong person fight would be great.
And yeah. As long as you realize, I have I actually have the musical Into the Woods stuck in my head now.
No, I hate to ask it. Do you have a excuse me. It's been a long day. All right. So y'all tromp out into the woods, and with the pictures, you're able to pretty easily figure out what section of the woods that they came from and went from. And the ground where the bodies were dumped was hard enough to not really take anything in the way of footprints. But once you actually get into the tree line, the ground is softer and you are able to pick out some 2 sets of ordinary tracks and 1 set with a cane. And they head into the woods. And the woods aren't deep enough for y'all to get lost or anything. There's no need for that. But as you progress a little bit further into the woods, there's a burn spot on the grass.
Does it look like fire? Did it, like an accelerant or maybe electricity?
As you look at it closely, it's actually two relatively small burned patches that probably fire. That are each patch is about 6 inches in diameter, and the two patches are about 6 feet apart. It looks like whatever it was. I'm sorry.
You said 6 inches in diameter?
Each one was about 6 inches in diameter, and the two are about 6 feet apart. It doesn't look like whatever it was burned for long. It was almost like a flash fire.
Like somebody was propelling themselves with.
Yeah, so I was wondering, like rocket or something.
Possibly.
I'm going to test that.
Okay, how are you going to test that?
I'm going to propel myself.
Okay.
See if the mark I leave behind is somewhere.
Cool. Go ahead and make that roll. Just because we're getting people used to mechanics.
I don't think I need to roll for that. Let me
check. Oh, okay.
I'm checking. He actually takes off his boots. Even though technically.
Oh yeah, there's no roll on that. Cool. Just yep. Go. Nifty.
So basically, he takes a little bit away. He takes his boots off. He everybody hears a zzz, and then he goes and see if it makes the same noise. Same spot. Everybody sees a flash of purple.
Nice. The grass underneath you is crispy, but it's not burned.
Well, yeah, I'm not fine.
Right. But also the grass underneath you is more or less where your feet were and like a little bit around, not 6 feet apart. So the area that you left was a larger diameter spot. So, I mean, it could very well have been a power usage, but it probably was not that.
Okay.
Yeah.
He goes and puts his boots back on.
Not unless it was two people flying together, but.
Possibly. Though the track that Advent left was the one larger spot as opposed to those two really small ones.
That tells me that at least either. The stronger dude has more than just strength, or two of them are novas.
Could be.
Maybe it's just miniature people.
I mean,
it's not impossible. Yeah, that actually is there. Power. Yeah.
See, I know. Well, we'd be surprised if it's very miniature, tiny people.
There are two circles, and there are two bodies that were found.
There we go.
It seems like it could also be related in some way to the two bodies.
There weren't any burn marks on those.
One of you figure this thing out. Look at the stuff. Figure out what happened here, because this isn't really my thing. One of you figure this out.
Oh, I don't know, white privilege. Why not use that white privilege in order to magic the solution to the air?
You know what? That's a good idea. I'll go and start looking around, just walking around like the area. Kind of like looking around like I know what the fuck I'm doing. Like I actually start like, you know, like movies or TV shows where I've seen like investigators like looking around like looking over a scene. I do that. But like I have no idea. Like, it's like clearly not real investigative work.
Crash looks over at everybody. You would be surprised how often this actually works for him.
And I'm going to use my luck. So
I have a feeling. I have a feeling this is how it's going to work.
Yeah. Every day in and day out. I don't even know why he hires me as a bodyguard. I don't understand.
I'm sure that
your
he's going to
personality, of course.
Oh yes.
All right. Perception, investigation, or something else?
Sure.
No perception. I'm like, do not see shit.
every dot of luck you use is an automatic success. Though.
I know.
Yep. I'm also going to investigate, points.
But I'm going to do it normal.
I got. Five successes.
So did I.
Oh, Lord.
I mean, remember, this is Mr. Lucky.
Yeah.
My privilege. So that's all I do is walk around and get lucky. And also I can take hits.
Oh, Lord. Okay, cool. All right. Well, as
I pick up a blade of grass.
And you pick up that blade of grass that you picked up that was between on a line between the two burn spots, and you realize, oh, yeah, there's this tiny, like thread thin line of burn down the length of that grass. So it looks like now that you've looked at random grass, just the right one. It's almost impossible to see it, but the two little burned patches are connected by a very, very thin line of burn between them.
Hey, look at this.
And as far as
quantum bolt,
Advent's more normal looking around, you actually find a sandwich wrapper.
Hey Hughes, do you have one of those and one of those plastic bags you people carry around?
Yep. Evidence bag. Yep. He'll reach into his pocket, snap on some gloves, open the bag, offer. Yeah, go ahead and put it in.
I am not wearing gloves.
Oh, for fuck's sake.
I actually just presume that it was for me. And I walk over and put the grass piece that I pulled up in the evidence bag.
Hughes pauses for a moment.
And then I pat Hughes on the shoulder and I say, send that for processing.
Hughes pauses, closes up the bag, puts it in his pocket, pulls out another bag, picks up the sandwich wrapper, puts it in, closes it up. And on both of those, he puts his signature. Where it's supposed to go on the outside of the bag. There we go. Yeah.
Like wait, well, you know, it's like with the sandwich wrapper, it's like instead of us picking up, treat the sandwich wrapper like dog poo with the bag.
It's okay. It's fine. So we have evidence to check, if nothing else, and we also have
suspects.
And now we have faces now. Hughes is now mentally trying to backtrack what steps would to have happened in order to get that footage legally. Where did you get that footage?
Advent looks up.
Lightweight looks up.
Well, there's just a really good camera angle. And he smiles. He looks up, then looks back at you. It was just a really good camera angle we happened to find.
Yeah, right. Hughes, you don't see anything. That's sky. Yeah. Well, at this point, that's trees, but whatever. Yeah.
Right.
We did our super Wooji Nova powers and we pulled it out of the ether.
So can you run all this through your computers and we can go and get this guy or these two people?
Three.
That's next, right? Three people.
Three.
That's a whole
We racket. Can at least start.
I think it would be a great time for our intrepid, our illustrious wrangler to call the chief of police with some preliminary information.
Okay.
And he actually smiles.
And I'll look over and go, we're Novas. You don't really think we're going to play by every rule that they have to, right?
I actually lean in really close to Hughes and I whisper in his ears, there's a satellite above us.
But more important than we're Novas, I'm also rich, so we can pretty much do whatever we want. That's the way the American government works.
There's a momentary flash on Advent's face of intense darkness before it goes away.
Here.
Hughes is hearing all of this, and from his pocket here, secret agent man, secret agent man. He jumps a little. He pulls out his phone. He answered it. Yep. I know. I got you. Thank you. All right. I'll see you later. Bye-bye. Yeah. Yep. Okay. So, yeah. I'll go ahead and give him a call. Where do you people want to go next?
You people. Shake my head. I thought we were more evolved than that.
Honestly,
they call me white privilege.
Honestly, at this point, I think getting somebody to sketch out the faces we saw, and then see if they're in any databases is the next step. Also, I'm sure the police would love to know that there were three people, and at once maybe all of them are enhanced individuals.
Mm-hmm. Do you have some kind of, I don't know, jump drive or SD card or something that you recorded the footage on that I can hand over to my bosses?
He looks at lightweight.
I do, but I suggest we make a copy of this before we hand it over to your boss.
Sure. Let's go for the computer where we can make copies.
Yes.
Excellent. So yeah, y'all can either trip
Hang on, Travis is muted. Or it looked like you were saying something, but yes.
I actually said, and maybe in the process of copying, maybe remove any potential identifying marks from the images.
Yeah, because each one of those satellite pictures has like a line of metadata across the bottom of it.
Yeah. Fair thing. Let's go. So I'm guessing we're going to go find a computer somewhere that is not the police station and probably someone's house, unless there's some sort of computer that he has access to, or he's just going to randomly luck into a brand new shiny computer where we can do all this stuff.
Does Lightweight have a laptop?
Yes.
There you go.
Lightweight can take care of this.
Out of character, is anybody here, like, isn't that the thing where you're hidden? What's the thing where you're hidden?
Cipher.
I've got cipher, yeah.
Yeah, is anybody, yes. I don't have any cipher. Like, I'm not hidden at all. So,
I do.
Yeah, my character has cipher as well.
That seems like that might be related to keeping, like, having a computer that's maybe not as traceable or...
Yeah.
Gotcha.
Yeah. Okay.
Go away.
Indeed. Excellent. So, I'm assuming that you've got your laptop with you, so that's not a problem. So, do y'all just like retire to a quiet spot and compute? Mm-hmm. Is that what's going on?
Seems like the best plan right now.
Excellent.
Yep.
Removing that access or that metadata from the satellite pictures is not a huge problem for you. I'm not even going to ask you to roll for it.
Oh.
What?
Is it possible that I could have taken pictures of the mark with my phone?
Oh, yeah, totally.
Like, how are yours starting to distort again?
Yeah, it's unfortunate because I love your character so much. It's hard. You're breaking up a lot.
Testing.
A little twitchy still.
We can hear you, but it is going out a little bit.
Yeah.
Shit. Here, let me try getting out and... Sorry?
It's sounding better now.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, it's intermittent. It's not consistent.
Which is almost worse. Okay.
Yeah.
I can try leaving and coming back.
Up to you.
Yeah, let me try and leave and come back.
Okay, Vicky. It's like, no internet, don't present us challenges.
Interwebs. I mean, having worked in IT for the internet for some time now, the internet is in fact held together by bubblegum and spite.
Yeah.
I believe it.
It absolutely is.
I thought it'd be more held together by, I don't know, spooge.
The internet is for porn.
A little bit of that too. Depends on which
the hardware is definitely bubblegum and spite and a little bit of a little bit of hatred for the world.
Testing.
Better.
Yeah, better.
Yay.
Okay.
Excellent. All right. Happy days. Cool.
Are here again.
Yes.
Off my brain cell, Travis.
But it's comfy there. Okay, cool. So yeah, y'all retire to a convenient quiet spot for computing goodness. And while Lightweight is doing his thing, what if anything are the rest of y'all doing?
Keeping an eye out, really. Because I mean, we did just go to a crime scene. It's very possible people are paying attention, and if they are, they might be suspects and
possibly. Go ahead and make me a perception awareness then.
Sugar. 5.
5. Awesome.
It's 8 or 7 or 8 or better. 7, right?
7 or better, yes.
Okay, 5.
Yes, excellent. Okay, cool. You notice that y'all are definitely attracting attention. White privilege particularly is attracting attention. There's a small clump of people that have gathered and are obviously cell phone videoing at what y'all are up to.
I have 3 in influence, actually, so I'm a celebrity.
Yeah, exactly.
So I smile for the camera. And
I short all the cameras out.
Do you really? Go for it. Oh, just mean. Okay. They're all smiling and happy and doing the thing.
It does not look like I'm shooting them. It's just this is suddenly the power just.
Considering this is 2009, you had only had second generation Android. You still have people using flip phones.
I got my flip phone.
You're still going to see some razors, probably.
Hey, razors weren't bad for the time.
Amanda?
Yeah. Did you botch?
Jesus Christ.
Someone's phone explodes.
People's computer phones literally disappear from their hands.
he looks over and he just kind of goes, huh, that's neat, and goes back to paying attention to Lightweight and does not look like he's actually paying attention to that. When suddenly all of those phones wipe.
Yeah.
It's like an EMP right there.
Yeah, I mean, all the phones wipe. 2 of them actually, a bzzzt of purple lightning actually arcs from one phone to the nearest phone next to it. And this clump of people just, oh, what up? Hey, did yours? Yeah, me too. Did yours? That sucks.
He looks over and he pulls out his phone. Holy shit, it happened to mine too. That's so weird. Fuck. Is your computer okay? Your computer's fine, by the way.
He surreptitiously checks his phone.
It's fine.
It's fine.
At which point the most of the crowd wanders away.
I'm paying attention to the ones who don't.
2 guys come right up and, hey, you're white privilege, aren't you?
That's do they look so like cool. Are they racer fan types?
No, these two are not. They're Nova U chasers. Fans. Yeah, they're Nova Chasers. Yeah, they're U fans.
They're groupies.
Mm-hmm. Wow, hey, dude, can we get your autograph?
Of course you can get my autograph. I actually have first impression too, so like I can immediately charm people, essentially, like right off the bat, unless I'm specifically trying to not like be annoying, yeah. Like, you know, the dick. So yeah, I say, of course, I can take a break from solving murders to give you some autographs.
Wow, and you're solving murders.
I pull out a white marker pen and I sign one of their faces.
I'm never gonna wash my face again.
In fact, one of them sees you sign in the face on the other one and immediately like pulls down her shirt so that you can sign her boob.
Well, I am actually lusty. I have the flaw of lusty, so I'm like, well.
I forgot about that. Beautiful. Okay.
It only penalizes me if I'm like actively being seduced, but yeah. I'm still just gonna play it in the moment as it's being cool. Like, well, I don't mind if I do.
And yeah, they
I spend a little extra time on that signature, we'll just say.
And she is highly appreciative.
Advent lights up a cigarette at that.
And she the guy that she's with is like trying to pull her away, but she actually slips you her number.
I hold it up and give her like a wink, but I'm really actually holding it up so the guy can see it. And then I put it away.
What a dick.
Never gonna call her, but at least it makes him feel bad.
My privilege turning girl's boyfriend into a cuck.
Look at your boyfriend. Now look at me.
Look back at me.
Sadly, he isn't me. But if he was a Nova, he could be like me. Never mind.
Oh, Lord. But yeah, eventually the Nova chasers get shooed off. And about that.
Use will help.
We get my security to get rid of them.
Oh, Lord. Oh, God. Are you actually sending Crash to deal with
I'll kind of lean in and say, it's time for them to go.
All right. Well, Crash will kind of shrug her shoulders a little bit and you hear her neck pop.
I'm gonna back Crash up.
Starts to step forward, eyeing them. And of course, if they follow him at all, they know.
Oh, yeah.
What happens when Crash comes forward?
One of them that seems to have more balls than sense actually tries to hold up a paper and pen towards you and then thinks better of it.
You're like a famous boxer, right? Or you were?
I was a known fighter.
Like an MMA kind of fighter? Is that right?
Yeah. I'm a little taken back by that. I'm not really sure. So I'm a little distracted now because that rarely happens. So I'll go on ahead and sign it.
Okay. Oh man, if she's a former like mixed martial arts performer or a boxer, then Advent probably knows absolutely who she is as somebody who used to gamble.
That's between y'all.
Yeah, I don't know how much.
I don't know that.
Did you want to maybe would he would know? Would he know that backstory element then?
Probably not. Probably just the public stuff.
I mean, what was it happened very publicly?
Yeah, something happened really publicly. So. If you don't want everybody else to know, you can send a message.
No, I mean it would have been all over the news. So yeah, when Crash erupted, she was in the middle of a fight and She hit somebody so hard that it killed them.
Oh.
And so she quit fighting after that.
That's fair.
Nice. Yeah. I mean, not nice, but nice.
Yeah. But awesome. She's definitely a little taken back because, you know, when she's around Mr. White Privilege, no one ever. Yeah. So, and even though she tries to ignore that part of her life, she's still just a little caught off guard. Like, what? Oh.
How much mega strength does she have? Does she have mega strength 5?
No.
Okay. Because otherwise, I guess if you had that much mega strength, that person didn't just die. They became paste. Like 3 or higher, it's nothing.
Sauce. Yeah. All right. Excellent. So, yes. Well, Garet, or while Lightweight has been able to then put in his request for information and strip all of the metadata out so that it's not obvious that y'all hacked a satellite.
Why wouldn't we? We're Novas.
I could have just flown up there, but that is tipping my hand too much.
Do you say that out loud?
Do not.
No, I do not. Okay. Got to make sure.
Beautiful. Yeah, your buddy gets back to you and says that it's going to take him a little bit of time to get access to those files, but that he'll get back to you. He's probably at least a couple hours.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah. So Hughes, are you keeping Popo updated or something else?
Oh yes. He is putting together the Ford mentally as we speak, and he'll write everything up. If necessary, he can call Chief Murphy, but this seems, I don't want to be calling her every 5 seconds. Hey, we got this. Hey, we got this, or something. Mm-hmm. Like, ice report. Here's all the stuff we got. He also wants to talk to Martinez at some point, but right now he's still dealing with these guys.
Yeah, make sure Martinez is actually breathing.
Yeah, about that. That
was a pretty good idea when I was like, he's out for the flu. Is he really?
And in fact, Chief Murphy actually ends up calling you, Hughes.
Shit.
Agent Hughes, do you have a moment to speak? I don't want to interrupt your investigation, but something of importance has come up.
Let me guess. Martinez is dead.
I believe...
Maybe his house is completely burned down?
Oh, his house is intact. Unfortunately, he is not.
Of course.
Okay. Literally. As in, he's in multiple pieces. In his house. The crime, the forensic team is on their way over to join the officer I sent over to check on his welfare and his well-being. But if you and yours would like to go over there as well, it's not completely certain that the two are connected, but it seems more likely than not.
Yes. I also need to update you on some new forensics that we found at the Boyd Speedway body drop. And he'll start telling her over the phone because he has no idea whether or not he's going to get targeted next. Oh. Blah, 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 blah. I've got the sandwich wrap. He's trying to be quiet and he's stepped away. He's basically trying not to be heard by the public. But he's not trying to be like super duper quiet. You could hear him, but it's not shouting across the room. So
gotcha. So yeah, anybody that's
up,
yeah.
I'm gonna walk up and be like, give me that card so we know his address. Martinez's address. So we
can
okay. Yeah. Since I have Martinez's card, I'm guessing it does not have his personal address. I'm guessing it would have like his phone number, his extension, and that kind of stuff.
Right. Yeah.
So I'd have to go to the police, like,
ask her.
He pauses for a moment and says, we need Detective Martinez's residence.
And if you can text. rattles it off. He lives on Igu Gap Road, which is over in East Brainerd. It's maybe 10 miles as the crow flies, or 15 minutes by car from where y'all are.
Got it. Yeah. He repeats the address to Advent.
Is this something more like we can just type it down also? To where
Yeah,
because police information is usually actually confidential in public records. You can't look it up by name.
I'll actually pull up my phone that's not broke. Look at the rest of the group, not at where their phones are, because I saw them earlier and I just text them the address, even though I don't have their numbers.
Nice.
We should go here. Martinez was killed.
Dismembered.
He points at you at that. He looks at white privilege. Meet you there.
That's not a surprise.
No. Meet you there. Do you want to fly over there? You just want to get in the car with us?
Well, it's starting to look
a little dangerous. For a minute.
It's looking a little dangerous, so I think I'll drive with you all.
Hop in. I've got a pretty big Escalade.
Yeah, you can all fit in.
Yeah, it's one of the big black Escalades that, you know, 2009 gangster rappers used to drive.
So probably a pretty nice car then?
Yeah, it's not bad. Like, it's not bad at all.
I kind of give you a little nod, grudging nod.
And then he'll actually kind of like usher Hughes while he's still on the phone into the car too, and we'll head that way while they talk.
Awesome. Yeah. Y'all make it over there with no difficulties. Igu Gap's one of the major arteries, but it has it's got a residential end of it, but the other end of it is a major shopping artery.
Also activate my U-Fiber.
Okay.
I change it to an actual super suit for this part.
Ah, gotcha. Right.
So this is interesting to me, because this seems to be a bit of a change of the pattern. This is somebody who is on to the investigation, killing for reasons other than getting these glands. An escalation, you might say.
Yeah, either they figured Martinez had an MR node and he fought back, or they're trying to distract. But I mean, where we're at right now, we have no reason not to check this out.
Martinez could have also come across something.
Yeah.
Ah, that's a good point. Smart, Hughes. Very smart.
Excellent. All right. So yeah, time y'all make your way over. It's not a problem. By the time that you get over there, there's two cop cars. There's the CSI type van. The ambulance is pulling out, but the coroner van is still there and obviously waiting.
Advance gets out of the car. His super suit is full black with purple highlights and a full face mask.
Okay. So we've got white
black boots. Noir.
Kind of. Like his head's not covered, but like his previously bald head looks like it actually has hair now.
Interesting.
Because all right. He's a thing.
Yeah. Oh boy. Okay. Cool. The cops recognize Hughes on site and therefore don't attempt to prevent y'all from coming in, though they do hand y'all all those crime scene booties and gloves.
Booty.
I look at them so amusedly, like, you know, like, oh, look at this.
Trash breaks the first pair. Get some more.
No, we need the size large or the bigger ones.
Just the plastic is so thin, it just
Martinez lives, or I should perhaps say lived, in a fairly small house. Looks like it's probably two, maybe three bedrooms. Single unit, not an apartment. Had a attached garage. that's currently closed. It has that sort of lived in, but not really together look that would typically indicate like a single person without a family, as opposed to, you know, a couple or what have you.
Real quick, Agent Hughes, how did the chief get word that Martinez was out sick with the flu?
I'll have to contact her. It could be that either Martinez himself called it in, whoever dismembered her or dismembered him called it in. Right now, we've just got the body. So
I thought I should ask that question just to kind of have it floating out there, since someone called to say he was sick.
Right.
Why then do they we'll call it dismembering when only one part of your body is called a member? Just a thought.
Right. Okay. So I'll turn to one of the forensics guys. Go ahead and walk us through the scene. What you got?
Yeah. Right. Well, I was sent over to do the welfare check. Chief asked me to come over. Martinez has been out with the flu for a couple of days, so we didn't really think anything of it. I knocked and there wasn't any answer. So I went around and made the perimeter search and looked in all the windows, didn't see anything, knocked again. Already had the chief's permission to go ahead and make entry. And as y'all came in the house, y'all could see that the front door had been punched. Not super punched, but like lock punched. Had permission to make entry, so I did. And bulk of the house is clean, but there's a couple of little burn spots. And Martinez is in the bathtub.
Show me the burn spots. Actually, it kind of sounds like show me the burn spots.
He takes you over into the kitchen where the linoleum is partly melted in the same 6-inch diameter spots, with it being linoleum instead of grass. You could easily see the connecting line between them, though in this instance the distance between the two burn spots is only about 4 feet instead of 6 feet from before. Looks like whatever did this was a smaller effect this time.
He looks at white privilege. He looks at the burn marks and just kind of nods at them. Like, kind of like that, look at that, check that out. and then he's going to wander towards the bathroom.
There are...
check that out. Just, hey, check that out. It's like, look, it's the same, you know. And then he wanders towards where the...
Yeah, I look at it and I nod and I just keep walking.
I'm acting like a superhero. From these people.
The help tells me something to do, I don't really like pay any attention to what they say.
I sense a fight coming.
And it's gonna be great. Cool. Yeah, see y'all. So Advent heads towards the bathroom, which is utterly clogged with forensic-y people. People taking pictures, people shooting video, people taking measurements, people taking samples. One guy looks up really annoyed that
we're going to need you to clear the area so that way we can do what we do.
And everybody just...
Nova's in the place. White privilege. Advent. These other folks.
And everybody files out, though as many of them as can stay in the doorway to watch do.
Shut.
Mm-hmm. I'm gonna
And I hold up my hand to one of them, like that's like talking, like just like right in his face, just like start looking around like this, like I know what I'm doing.
He's gonna do this thing. I
like point out a couple of things without saying anything.
So one thing about Evan's super suit is actually does have gloves. He's gonna check out Martinez's head.
Hang on, Howard was trying to say something.
Oh, sorry.
Yeah.
So while these two are doing their thing, Hughes is going to talk to the forensic techs. How long have they been here? What have they figured out so far? That kind of thing. Because if Martinez is in pieces, let's see what kind of pieces we're dealing with. Because they're going to find it out in 2 seconds. But
yeah. Forensics tells you that they've been on site for about 20 minutes. The first cop on site was about an hour ago. They had just begun to take all of their samples and measurements when your companion threw them all out. And they express a great deal of concern over hoping that they don't disturb the crime scene.
I'm going to make sure that there's at least samples of them so that they can be included in the exclusionary.
That's just to
make sure that any fingerprints or whatever they've got can be excluded from what evidence is here. Yeah. Out of character, I know, but at the same time, this is his best, and he just keeps dealing with wow. Yeah, so
you're distorting badly, Howard.
Crap.
Okay. While Howard's working on that, inside, he's stacked in the bathtub. His arms and legs have been pulled off.
So he was actually ripped apart, not sawed apart.
Correct. Okay. I mean, like dismembering a chicken.
Okay.
Pop. Yeah. His head and torso are still connected, but the arms and legs are separate.
Okay. So I just lean the head up and look. Did they?
No.
They just ripped him apart. Okay.
Just based on the everything's dry and tacky and all, so likely he's been dead for hours at least, and possibly even a full day. Forensics could probably tell y'all better than that, unless y'all wanted to really work it out. But this is not fresh.
And then looks at White Privilege and goes, do you want to have some fun? Don't shush me.
And I'm going to point at something.
Are you going to use luck?
Yeah.
I'm going to viciously point.
So a 10 counts as 2?
Yes.
7 successes.
Jesus. Oh my God.
That's such a great power.
It is.
You only use it once per scene.
Yeah.
And I feel like I gotta really like be selective. The moments have been perfect for it though. So
you point at there's a part of a footprint or a shoe print in blood.
I open the door.
I take my glove off. Okay. And I hold the glove, like, you know, they do in the shows when they don't actually put the glove on. And I like kind of probe around the area. Check this out. And I like point to it with the glove that's being held by my hands.
I open the door and I grab one of the forensic people and I pull them in and I point down at the footprint.
We were in the process of taking pictures.
You chuckle fucks can get the fuck out of the bathroom so they can do the job.
It'll definitely be included. We're pretty sure that that's Martinez's blood, but we'll have to run the tests.
Hughes is right. If you all don't, if you all keep investigating and or keep disrupting the scene, we're not going to be able to get the work that we need to get done taken care of.
Crash is just losing her shit in the background with chuckle fucks. Like, that is such a perfect description of him.
I mean, I assume that he's talking to everybody else, not me.
When Hughes yells, all of the lights in the house dim for a minute.
Beautiful.
Like they go, light,
yeah. Lightweight, where do you go when you walk through the wall?
God. Because, you know, when Lightweight hears the agent lose their temper, he knows who the agent is referring to. So, and also he's going to be intangible this entire time, so that this way he's not actually just touching anything.
Ever.
So when I'm looking at the bathroom, you know what, is the bathroom like in the hallway, or is it like off the bedroom? It's like, is it connected to a master suite?
This one's off the master suite. Or off the, so, yeah.
So I'm going to go into the actual bedroom itself, mm-hmm. because if he was killed here, he probably was brought here from the bedroom itself. So you know what? I'm going to go and do perception and investigation, looking for anything by the bed or in the bedroom itself.
Okay.
Not great. Only two successes that time.
Okay.
I need to take a couple minutes, so that'll be good for him to do his thing.
Gotcha. Okay, cool. All right, so you are right. Cool. Yeah, there are forensics people that were shoved out of the bathroom, and they're sort of milling around, lingering here, and some of them are taking pictures, but you notice that there are two sets of footprints and a set of drag marks that, like, they might have, like, they might be heel prints,
mm-hmm.
Leading into the bathroom. And the bed has obviously been slept in and is mussed up and that sort of thing.
Okie dokie. Does it look like they... I'm trying to think of what I want to ask here. So they actually use something to punch in the lock on the door.
But the cop punched in the lock on the door.
The cop did. Yeah. How did they get... I'm looking around trying to figure out how they got into the house itself. Because even if a teleporter... Usually teleporters had to have been to a place once to teleport mm-hmm. there. Mm-hmm. So how did they get into the house?
For one thing, there is an extra on teleportation that you can teleport blind, though it is more difficult and a little bit dangerous. But you'd also teleportation also works just fine if they can see that. I mean, if they could look in through a window, then they could teleport into the room just fine if that was what was going on.
So do I have reason to believe that these char marks that they're leaving on the floor is a remnant of teleport?
Go ahead and make me an intelligence academics, please.
Okay.
Yeah.
Let's see. Intelligence. And... let's see, can I die? Two successes.
Okay. You know that teleportation in itself doesn't tend to leave any kind of marks, but there is a more advanced version known as warp that actually opens up portals. And depending on how an individual Nova's powers work, the portals tend to be thematic. And if it was like themed around fire, then there's a very good chance that it might leave a mark similar to that.
Kind of like Nightcrawler's brimstone smell.
Kind of, yeah. Except what Nightcrawler does is definitely teleportation, whereas this would be almost like
a gate.
Yeah, like almost like a Stargate without the actual apparatus.
Okay.
Yeah.
Would that seem to align with the size of the sorry, can't quit yelling today. The sinuses have not been happy with the weather shifts.
Oh dear.
No.
So
man dying.
Yeah. So when we saw them like 6 feet apart in the woods and we see them like 4 feet apart here inside, does this make me think that what I'm seeing here is kind of that warp ability that's being...
It's a reasonable supposition that the other was... that the one here at the house was a smaller... if that was the case, that it would have been a smaller gateway. Whether that was a less successful use of the power or just not needing the gate to be as big. That's hard to say, but it's a reasonable supposition that that could be what was doing it.
Here's a question for you. And, you know, I don't know if Lightweight would know this or not, but there were three people that had to go through the gate. If it was a warp ability like that, there were three that had to do it in the woods.
Plus carrying the two bodies. Yeah.
If the size of the warp is necessary for the number of people going through it, and it's not a fixed size, it would explain why just coming into a house would only require a smaller size gate.
It's a reasonable supposition.
Lightweight's going to go... you know what? I'm going to take out my... I am going to step away from everybody to where I'm by myself, and I'm going to call my ally and kind of... Because it would be a very specific power set.
Yes, that would definitely be helpful for them to know.
I'm going to go ahead and tell them what I found and say this might be the powers that we're seeing.
Gotcha. Excellent. He adds that into his, he's basically building a list of known potential options. He'll add that into his criteria for searching.
Thank him very much. Sorry for keep interrupting his day, but this is worrisome.
You think? Excellent. Okay, cool. So Hughes is dealing with the real forensics people. Lightweight is dealing with his ally. White Privilege is making an ass of himself.
Crash is laughing at it, yeah. Which is funny.
And Eddie is having a moment. Excellent. All right.
Eddie actually goes outside and lights up a cigarette. That seems to like the mask goes up to here, and the cigarette just.
Excellent. All right. Yeah. So, cool. What's everybody else doing?
Let me ask something really quick. The burn marks.
Uh-huh.
Does it look like fire burns or does it look like electrical burns?
It looks like fire or possibly a superheated object. It looks like a heat and or fire as opposed to electricity or something like that.
Cool.
Mm-hmm. While everybody's in the house, I'm actually going to case outside and see if I can see like points of entry or like anything that's not the cops walking around.
Cool. Go ahead and do me a perception of either investigation or awareness.
That's the same roll. So.
Okay.
I dropped a dice.
Oh no!
It's okay. I've got monkey feet. I can just pick them up.
Creepy.
You can't.
No, I got a hammer toes. Four successes. All right, cool.
I've been able to use an ink pen with my toes, Amanda.
Freak. Okay. Yeah, you find the back door, no problem. The windows are fairly obvious, no problem. There's a kitchen. There's a connection from the garage to the kitchen. And there's also a window that anybody looking into the kitchen from either the window or the garage door could have easily seen where the warp came out, where the burn marks, where you can see them from the window. As you're moving around the outside of the house, you also find three more sandwich wrappers.
Same sandwich?
They're all looking like gas station sandwiches, like those horrible cut into triangles and set next to each other in a plastic.
Yeah, but even those that will have a little sticker on them telling you what kind of sandwich it is.
Yeah, yeah. Two of the one that you found at the racetrack was ham and cheese, and these are turkey.
Are there logos on the wrappers?
Yeah, I was going to say, like, Parker's stores have cameras.
That's true. All of them are Parkers.
All of them are Parkers.
Yeah.
Parkers is a pretty... Parkers in Chattanooga is kind of like the Wawa and some of those bigger gas stations, right? It's one of the trucking.
Mm-hmm. It can be, yeah. They often are, yeah.
Okay. After I'm done with my phone call, I'm going to hunt down Advent and Agent Hughes, because I'm pretty sure that white privilege is not going to spare enough attention to the plebeian that he'll even notice that I'm not there. And again, it's like I think we're dealing with somebody whose Nova ability involves making a gate. It's different than teleportation. It's kind of like think about the movie Stargate that they could walk through, and imagine that is the power. So it's like a gate or a warp that you're passing through versus the Nova ability of teleportation. Because all they have to do is be able to see where they're putting the gate. And the burn marks are... Sorry, go ahead, Amanda.
Actually, with warp being the more powerful ability, as long as they even have a vague notion, it helps. Seeing makes things easier, certainly, but they don't have to see with the...
I will clarify then.
Yeah.
Like, they don't even have to see where they're placing the gate, the warp ability. It is more powerful than teleport. That would explain how they're able to move. And if it's creates a gate-like effect, this would explain the marks we're seeing, where it looks like they're putting legs of each side of a gate.
I want to get to Martinez's research to see what he might have been like, especially the more recent stuff. And then Advent, have you... I apologize for yelling. It was getting deeply irritating. Did you happen to find anything?
Yeah, I found three more sandwich wrappers right here near this window where I can see the kitchen and those scorch marks. So that the warping idea makes sense. As for the yelling, respectfully, if you want us to investigate, you have to stay out of our way.
There's a difference between letting the forensics do their job and just barging in. They can get us the information. They've been able to get the information so far. I want to be able to use that so that we can focus our attention on something they can't get.
At the same time, in that we are in agreement, which is why we did what we did. We wanted to get in and see what we could see before they finished touching everything, in case there was something that we could see that they could not.
Wait a second. You were yelling at us?
I'm outside. Are you outside?
Yeah,
yeah. Lightweight said he was getting Hughes and Advent, and I'm guessing that we would have gone outside. Okay.
Yeah, oh yeah, well, Advent was outside looking around.
Lightweight went looking for y'all, and he was making sure he was nowhere near, you know, Captain Whitebread.
But yeah, I think it's like, it was the, assuming that the that he wasn't going to pay attention to the plebeians anyway.
Mm-hmm. No, I mean, but that's exactly it. I wouldn't have paid attention to any other detail of the conversation except for the moment when something said that indicates that he is not the expert.
But,
you know, it's fine. If you don't want me to be there, I'm not there.
Nah, it's whatever. You can be there if you want. I'm just saying we were outside. Just, you know, keep in mind that, you know, maybe we're not just being assholes. That said, if you have those bags, he points at the wrappers. The idea of someone being able to use a gate, though, is disturbing, because I can't, like, how far can someone use those? Like, can't they go miles? Like, so there's no way to determine where they, like, that cuts off a significant portion of information we can get from any of the crime scenes if they're just...
Well, there might be some sort of particulates in the boot print that might indicate from where they came. Perhaps there is some sort of gravel or dirt related to a specific place that they teleported from or warped from. And then we can find out where they are.
Did you just directly recite that from CSI?
You know, I was about to ask the same question.
Boom, boom.
That's Law and Order.
Whatever.
it makes sense that white privilege would mistake that too. So just they're all the same.
No, I would said that exactly because I'm saying that because that's exactly what I would have heard on a television procedural show.
Yeah, and that's why.
But I did get a 7 in my investigation.
You did, yeah.
So, like, I mean, at the same time, that's a super success. So
it is.
I actually saw shit that they did not see.
Exactly.
And yeah, exactly. And you did see that there were, like, I mean, obviously, the print itself was done in blood, but there were actually little chunks of mud that were dislodged and therefore stuck in the blood, that it'll take some analysis to figure out where the mud probably came from, but it's very likely that it came from wherever they warped from.
Probably. Point is, relax, Hughes. We got this all under control. Maybe we should take a break. We've been doing investigative work all afternoon. Maybe we go get a drink, get to know each other a little bit better. I know a great club. What do you think?
I think that sounds like a fantastic idea. What, right? We're not hired after hours, right? This was a 9 to 5 or 6 job. So I think we're off the clock
now. 9 to 4, wasn't it?
9 to 4 for you, maybe.
What's the name of the club?
Lux.
Amanda, do I know who the owner of that is?
Sure, why not? You've sure. Yeah, that would be Andy Anders.
It's at the top of some like really tall building, and it's very exclusive and expensive.
That's Andy Anders that runs the place, though he never actually is seen there. He's a silent partner for the public owner.
Okay.
The owner and I go way back. Come on, let's blow off some steam. We just got to meet each other. We've been solving murders all day long. I think it's time for us to put aside some of the tension that I see is arising. It seems like some of you aren't getting along with each other. So it might be a good idea for us to sit back, have a couple of drinks, and relax.
Secret agent man.
And there's something getting lost in a crowd to separate everybody. If you happen to need your own personal space from someone in particular.
Or excuse me, you'll step back well away from the others and you'll be talking on the phone. Yeah, I know. I know.
Probably telling his partner that he won't be home early tonight.
Out of character, am I crunchy? Because my thing just said bed. Okay, so let me.
Yeah. We didn't hear anything you just said.
Yeah.
I can hear you. We can hear you having the faux phone conversation, and then after that, it started to like break up a bit.
Yeah. Gotcha. But is it better now?
Yes.
Yeah. Yep.
Hey, just wanted to make sure.
I wonder if it's not a weather thing too. Oh, well,
I don't know. Anyway. Mm. Yeah. But yeah, he has a quick conversation, and his face does soften a little bit as he says goodbye, and he turns off the phone and puts it back in his pocket and rejoins the group.
Excellent.
Yep. So. Come on, let's do it.
We've let the cops know everything we know, right?
Unless y'all choose not to.
I'm gonna go.
I mean, I essentially order them to do the analysis on the particulates.
Right. Okay. Sure.
Yeah, fuck it. Let's go get a drink.
I'm gonna have a 5 in charisma. I mean, you know what I mean? Like, and I have a great first impression, and I haven't actually been trying to piss anybody off, even though I perpetually do. In this case, I am not actively doing it.
That's beautiful. So the cops are just like, yeah, we could totally do that.
Yeah, totally. Absolutely. Yeah, anything you say, man. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Glad to do it. Mm-hmm. Yep. Yep. Yep.
Which is why he's having an aneurysm.
Where
did you put my car? Oh, your car? I thought you're flying everywhere this time.
I'm going to go back to the station to report in.
Cool.
Go pick up a couple things and then I'll meet you at Lux.
Excellent.
You'll go looking for your car and you'll find it immediately.
No doubt.
Well, I was trying to, in a certain way, push us towards a good stopping point as well.
Exactly.
Gretchen and I have the sitter's going to be here any minute. And so, like, better to not end in the middle of us.
Yeah, I agree. Now would be a lovely place to stop. I am going to call this 4 XP for everybody as a base. Everybody gets learning curve as soon as each person tells me something that they learned about either ICLE or OOCLE about this game. Garet, what have you learned? Actually, Rob and Gretchen got to go soon. We're going to start with them. Gretchen, what have we learned?
I learned the circles that I need as many dice for each circle.
That is a good thing to learn. Awesome. Rob, what has Rob learned?
I learned that this game isn't just a fighting against things game. This is a really great investigative game. I really have enjoyed this investigation part of it. It's been very, very fun.
Yay!
I didn't know how that would work when you have people that can do almost anything.
True.
And it feels really awesome. I love that. What a surprise. Excellent. Wonderful surprise.
Yay! Howard, what has Howard learned? Howard is muted.
Howard was deliberately muted. Well, he has definitely learned the comp, like a lot. I had an idea of like, okay, so these were the ideas that we had for characters, and now I'm seeing the characters in play.
It never survives exposure.
Yeah. Oh man. I really am going to be just like, okay, let's pretend that we're doing paperwork. Okay. So yeah, that's what I learned.
Hughes is a paladin. Lawful, deliberately unobservant. All right. Advent, what's Travis learned?
Advent has learned that he is infinitely more patient than he realized.
Okay, I'll be ready.
And Garet, what's Garet learned?
I've learned that actually my character is much better at investigating than what he thought he was when I built him.
Awesome. Excellent. And who do we want to nominate as MVP?
I have to go white privilege. I'm sorry.
Well, are you guys sure? Like, I actually would say I thought Howard was excellent. I loved Howard's character. I thought it was incredible. It's not too much, is it, guys? Because, I mean, you know me personally. That's the only reason why I would play this character, because he really is annoying. If it's too much, please let me know for real. It will not hurt my feelings. I don't want to make the game unfun for anybody by being a really obnoxious character.
I personally would actually go with Rob and Howard on this one for the first game, because it was such a perfect contrast.
I'm fine with that. We'll give it to both of them.
The Wrangler was having a hard time wrangling the cats and the cat.
And even watching Howard's facial expressions during the... I'm like, oh, there's the aneurysm. What's the blood pressure right now?
And I would like to point out, Rob, that if... it's pretty clearly the character. So, like, if there's going to be any kind of, like, confrontation, it'll be in character. I don't think you have anything to worry about.
All right. I am modeling the character after the early seasons of Lucifer, the Lucifer character on the Lucifer television show. So, and he's like a guy who basically knows nothing but lucks his way into solving mysteries and shit.
Nice.
And I was kind of looking at Howard's character as the detective who actually knows what they're doing and has to just deal with the annoying, like, you know, whatever character. But really, at any point, if it ever gets to a point where you guys are like, fuck, this guy, he needs to chill out, like, please let me know, because I won't take it personally. I just want everybody to have fun. So our sitter is here, so I'm gonna end the stream, but if you guys want to stay on here, you're welcome to.
Awesome. Just shoot me the file when it converts, please, Rob.
All right, will do. Yeah. Thanks, everybody, for tuning in. I guess about a month until the next one.
About a month, yep.
All right.
All right. Thank you.
Thanks for watching, y'all. Subscribe and...